Okay, welcome everybody to the Capitola City Council meeting. Before we get started, I am going to turn this over to our first Chloe.
Hi. Thank you, Mayor Brooks. Okay, I'm having technical difficulties. One second. So, okay, I'm so sorry. Welcome to the Capitola City Council meeting. In accordance with the current health order in our county and the governor's executive order and 2020, this meeting is not physically open to the public. Council and staff are meeting via Zoom, and there are several ways for the public to watch and participate. Information on how to join the meeting using Zoom and a landline or mobile phone, along with how to submit public comment during the meeting tonight, is available on our website, cityofcapitola.org, on the slides now shown, and on the published meeting agenda. As always, this meeting is cablecast live on Charter Communications Cable TV, Channel 8,
and is being recorded to be rebroadcast on the following Wednesday at 8 a.m. and on Saturday following the first rebroadcast at 1 p.m. on Charter Channel 71 and Comcast Channel 25. Meetings can also be viewed live from our city website. Tonight, we have two technicians from Community Television. Their names are Noel and Alex. Thank you for being here, and Mayor Brooks, back to you.
Thank you so much. I'd love for everyone tonight, just please remain on mute unless you are the speaker. Okay, so we're going to move on to item number one, Pledge of Allegiance. Please join me. I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all. Thank you. All right, we're going to move on to item two, and this is a report out on closed session. Ms. Butler? And you're muted.
Sorry about that. Good evening, Mayor and Council. Closed session was held on the item on the agenda and no action was taken.
Very much. Next on to item three, additional materials. Do we have any additional materials tonight?
Yes, Mayor, there were several additional materials for tonight's agenda. The first being the resolution for item 7E. For item 7G, an updated easement was sent out. For item 8B, we received one comment. Item 8C, we received four comments. And for 8D, there was one letter for that item. So those are all the additional materials.
Thank you very much. Okay, moving on to item four, additions and deletions to the agenda. Do we have any additions or deletions? Let's do a sound test again for you, Jamie. I think you said something.
Staff has no changes to the agenda this evening.
Thank you. Okay, item five for public comments. Do we have any public comments?
Mayor Brooks, I do not see anyone with their hand raised, and I do not see any emails on this item.
Okay, moving right along. We'll now move on to item six. This is for city council and staff comments. We'll start with staff. Do we have any comments from staff this evening?
Mayor Brooks, I do have one announcement I wanted to make. You may recall during the goal setting session, we talked about a potential partnership with the city of Scotts Valley around our recreation programs. I've been in communication with the city manager for the city of Scotts Valley, and they've elected to pursue a different path. They tell me that they're planning on working with a nonprofit partner to provide summer recreation services in Scotts Valley. So we won't be bringing back any potential recruitment to Scotts Valley.
Thank you. Okay, moving on to item seven. Councilmember, you are muted.
Yeah, I was recently talking with the executive director of the RTC, Guy Preston, And I asked if he would like to do a presentation. He's done one in the past, but the RTC has gotten a significant grant that's helping to fund many of the improvements on Highway 1, including Bus on Shoulder, which is something a lot of people are anticipating. I asked if he could do a presentation on that and an update on the trail rail issue. And he said he was very glad to do that, but he'd like to have a conversation with Jamie to figure out, you know, if that fits into your schedule and also to go over the content. So Jamie, if that's agreeable with you and the city, I think it would be a great informative presentation to the people of Capitola. Thank you.
Thank you. I just wanted to take a moment to address my thoughts on some issues that we've seen happen, not only in our community, but throughout the state and throughout the nation recently. One of them is that since the start of the pandemic and more recently, honestly, we've seen an increase in hate and hate crimes against our Asian American Pacific Islander community. And I want to take the moment right now to condemn that kind of behavior and that kind of hate and to reaffirm that there's no place for it in Capitola or in our state or in our nation. And on that same train of thought, throughout the city recently, people have been finding rocks and signs that say no white guilt on them. It's disturbing to find, not only for myself, but for others in our community, especially for our BIPOC community in the city of Capitola. And again, I want to take a moment to condemn these kinds of actions, behaviors, and statements in our city, and to reaffirm that all people are welcome here, and that these kinds of actions and behaviors to specifically indicate that there should be no white guilt or that there's certain members of our community that aren't welcome are exactly why we have people reaching out with concerns about whether or not Capitola is a welcoming place. And so I would encourage us all to take a moment to find ways to make sure that we are continuing to affirm that Capitola is a welcoming place, rather than to continue to perpetuate the kind of ideas that we're seeing in these flyers and rocks and hate that's happening throughout our community, not only recently since the pandemic, but also historically. And that's all from me this evening. Thank you.
Thank you, Councilmember. I couldn't have said it any better. I appreciate you bringing that up tonight. My thoughts are also with the families that the lives that have been lost in the community and throughout the country to gun violence. There's been just a lot of going on in regards to the hate and violence, and we have a lot of work ahead of us, and I'm just so proud to be a part of a community with you, Kristen, who's leading these groups and these really courageous conversations, and I appreciate being a part of that, so thank you so much. I would just like to add that there's a couple of, on a bit of a lighter note, that the Capitola Chamber is hosting its annual egg hunt, but a little bit different this year. You will not see thousands of adorable children on our beaches. They are doing scavenger hunts throughout the village, and so to learn more, you can visit their website. Also, this is just a reminder to everyone to please continue to wear your masks and socially distance. I know there's been a lot of updates moving from one tier to another, but the message remains the same. Please continue to socially distance and wear your mask. And lastly, I'd like for staff, if we could have a report back at a later meeting about an update on our environmental commission. Each of us are appoint somebody on the environmental commission, but we just have not heard it from them or know what's going on. And so I just love to get an update on that. And I see Councilmember Kaiser can raise. Those are all my comments for now. Councilmember?
Oh, thanks. I can give a brief update. I just met with the group for this first time on last Wednesday. And we are kind of in talks about putting in more mandates for the to-go containers, utensils, things like that, when it comes to restaurants within Capitola, making the mandate more of a mandate than it is at this point in time, along with many notes that we've been getting on behalf of gas-powered leaf blowers. So those are things that have been discussed. The group is in works of making a presentation for council, and so we'll receive a more in-depth and more informational post than I can give today. But that's kind of the
that's perfect.
Wow. And it's a really cool group, so I'm glad to be on it. So yeah, thanks.
Awesome. Thank you so much. Okay, so moving forward, we're going to move on to item 7 for consent calendar. All items listed in the consent calendar will be enacted as one motion in the form listed below. There will be no separate discussions on these items prior to the time the council votes on the action unless a member of the city council requests specific items to be discussed for separate review. Would council like to pull any items before moving on? And I entertain a motion.
Move to accept
I'll second.
Thank you.
All right. We got
that was
first
fast. Appreciate it.
That's wonderful. Can I have a roll call, please?
Absolutely. Councilmember Bertrand.
I approve.
Councilmember Kiger.
Aye.
Councilmember Peterson.
Aye.
Vice Mayor Story.
Aye.
Mayor Burke.
Aye. Okay, now we're going to move on to item 8. This is general government. Go to item 8A, the 2021 Community Development Block Grant, public hearing to consider potential activities. And I believe this is Ms. Harley's item.
Good evening, Mayor Brooks and Council. This evening we have Paul Ashby with us, who is going to present this item for you.
Good evening, Mayor, members of the council. Good to see everybody again. I am back to do another public hearing for CDBG, which seems like it's constantly happening. So at the last meeting, I gave you a pretty good update on the next NOPA, your notice of a funding availability, which is coming out for 2021. And tonight we're actually going to have the public hearing for that item. So I'm going to head and share my screen with you. And I trust you all can see that. Thumbs up. Good. Okay, thank you. So if you will remember and recall from our last meeting, the notice of funding availability comes out every year. I'm just going to briefly hit on a couple of these slides before we get into the recommendations, just so that everybody can refresh their memory. Housing and Community Development Department issued this NOPA on January 29th for $30 million. This is typically their annual allocation. Every year it goes down a little bit, but this has been pretty standard for the last few years. Funds are provided to cities in the form of grants for housing, public services, economic development, infrastructure, and more. And as you'll recall, we always have to meet a national objective with these funds, which typically is going to fall under the low, moderate income persons. In this NOPA, we can apply for up to 3 different groups slash activities. You'll see there on the screen, we have homebuyer for $500,000, house rehab for $500,000, public services for $500,000, planning and technical assistance for $250,000, and economic development and business assistance for $500,000. Maximum award for the jurisdiction is $1.5 million, and these applications are going to be due on April 30th, 2021. So in meeting with staff over the last couple of weeks and kind of looking at the past experiences that the city's had with CDBG, we really felt like public service was the way to go with this application. As many of you are aware, we have done some housing programs in the past in the city. They're pretty difficult just based on the purchase price limits that we have and some of the market that Capitola hosts. This year is also a little bit different because we can't do infrastructure. that's actually not going to be open. So our recommendation is to focus on public services. So that's the only slide you're going to see tonight. If you do want to discuss any of those other items though and activities, I'm happy to go over those again with you should the council want to. So just a couple of general ideas here for public services again: homeless, recreational services, healthcare, food, crime prevention. The list really goes on and on. It's going to be used to pay for the actual salaries for the people that put this together, supplies, labor, you know, many expenses that you can cover in this grant. So once we decided on public services, we then met to come up with a recommendation on who might be the best fit for this program. You're obviously going to recognize a couple names on this list. We met the staff, we reached out to these organizations to see if they would have any interest in pursuing these funds. As council is aware, these groups are already receiving community development CARES money through the Coronavirus Act. So this would be a separate grant in addition to. So the amounts you can see below are what the organizations proposed to us, which actually fit pretty well within that $500,000 cap. We would be able to apply for all three of these, not to exceed $500,000. As you can see there on your screen, we have Gray Bears, the food distribution program, the Second Harvest Food Bank, and the Community Bridges, Meals on Wheels, and Lift Line. If you're successful, these awards would most likely be in fall 2021. And with their typical annual cycle, the funding period is actually for 36 months. So much longer than CARES money, CD money. So once we executed a contract, these organizations would actually have 3 years to expend the dollars. So they have quite a bit of time that they would be able to utilize these funds. And when staff and I reached out to these organizations, we made it clear that it would be more a three-year cycle than what they thought that they might be able to use specifically in this city. So the recommendation tonight, CDBG always requires that we have a formal public hearing that we have noticed. So the recommendation would be to open the public hearing, receive any, close the public hearing, and then have council discussion. If the council sees fit, we would ask that you recommend that staff move forward with preparing an application, and that resolution would come back to you on April 8th for formal adoption, and the application would be submitted to the state no later than April 30th, 2021. And that is a brief overview of that. I'm going to stop sharing my screen, and I would be happy to answer any questions that the mayor and the city council members may have at this time. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Mr. Ashby. I'll go ahead and ask, see if there's any questions from council. Vice Mayor Stewart.
Thank you, Mayor. And thank you, Paul. It's good to work with you again. I just wanted to maybe get some clarification because one of our prior meetings when we were talking about our community grants program using general fund dollars, and I believe I wasn't sure whether it was CDBG recipients or CARES recipients should not also receive general fund dollars, and therefore, you know, shouldn't bother to provide an application for our community programs. So I was just wondering if you had some clarification on that.
Sure. Thank you, Councilman Story. So two items there that we can hit on. So first with the CARES money, they hit on the duplication of benefits a lot in the guidance that comes out with. And that's basically meaning you cannot pay for something twice with these monies. And so in this case, I don't think there'll be a duplication of benefits to any of these programs. They're very concerned with folks. Let's say the city of Capitola did a rental assistance program, and at the same time, the state's coming out with theirs that we've just heard about, their emergency rental assistance program. They're really looking to make sure that we're not funding the same groups of people, the same activities, and they're receiving basically double dip, for lack of a better word, for the duplication of benefits. The second caveat with these funds that I think you're hitting on, council member, is also they say that CDBG funds and regs should never supplant other federal money that's already been programmed for it. So the idea is they don't have a big pot of money sitting there that they've receiving a grant, and then, oh, we'll just come in and fund this with the city of Capitola, CDBG fund instead. So ideally, we're not supplanting any federal dollars with these as well. So I hope that answers your questions.
Yeah, it does. Thank you very much.
Absolutely.
Councilmember Bertrand, do you have a question? Go ahead and unmute yourself.
Yeah. Is there any reporting requirements here to the city of Capitola or to the feds?
Yeah, so that's a great question, council member. So the reporting will fall to your subrecipient. So the city is basically a pass-through agency to the subrecipient, to Great Bears, Community Bridges, Second Harvest. Right now, we have them required to report on a quarterly basis to the city, and the city in turn reports to HCD on a quarterly basis, as well as an annual report on what you've done with the funds. Those quarterly reports can be the same as your drawdown request, as well as a status update on where you stand with those funds. They up to $500,000, I will just hit on now since you brought it up, include 7% that the city is able to take for general administration, which would cover city staff time or myself to assist with those reports and prepare those. So ideally, everything would come out of the grant, nothing would get hit to general fund for the administration.
What's the tenor or the gist of the reporting? It's like how many meals have been delivered, or how many rides have been delivered, or does it go into a little bit more detail in terms of improvement of lives, improvement of situations that they're actually working in?
Well, I would say that HUD always likes to see it go further and say how they're actually improving these lives rather than just one meal provided to somebody. Does that really make the biggest difference? But to be honest, the report is going to look at who you assisted. So it's going to be demographics on the individual that they're providing the meals to. So if it was a senior meals on wheels program, let's say, Community Bridges would be providing unduplicated reports for individuals that they've served, that we would collect income and demographic information on them that we report. And then probably in the narrative is where we can add how many meals of food, how many pounds of food maybe were purchased, anything else that they would like to add in that.
Great. Any other questions before we move to public comment or this public hearing? Okay. All right. We're going to move to our public hearing portion if there's any comments from the audience.
Mayor Brooks, I do not see anybody with their hands raised, and I do not see any email communications on this item.
Okay. Thank you. So I'll bring it back to council for further discussion and a vote. Do I have a motion?
Yeah, I'll.
Councilmember Peterson.
Motion.
Oh. Councilmember Peterson?
I think Vice Mayor Story just made a motion, so I'll second his motion.
Fabulous. And can I have a roll call, please?
Councilmember Bertrand.
I approve.
Councilmember Kaiser.
Aye.
Councilmember Peterson.
Aye.
Vice Mayor Story.
Aye.
Mayor Brooks.
Aye. Okay, that item passes unanimously. We're going to now move on to item B. This is outdoor dining and village parking program discussion. And I see, thank you, Katie. I see, Katie, what's your item?
This is my item. Good evening, Mayor Brooks, council members. So give me a second here while I share the screen. All right. Can everyone see okay? I'll take that as a yep, I see a thumbs up. All right. So as a reminder for everyone, during our goal setting session a couple meetings ago, we talked about potential goals around the long-term plan for outdoor dining. long-term plan around potentially looking at our parking rates in the village. There appeared to be unanimous interest on the council, from the council in looking at the outdoor dining plan, but there was less consensus about whether or not we should be looking at the village parking rates at the same time. So at the meeting of the goal setting session, the council directed staff to continue this item and bring back a little more information for further deliberations. So the outdoor dining, I think everyone will remember that began in June of 2020, last year, when we issued an emergency order that allowed brick and mortar businesses to move outdoors to provide safer opportunities for people to conduct business. There's 32 cities, businesses around the city that have permits. And there's 15 restaurants or parklets is the term that we use that are conducting business outside in the public right of way in the village right now. And also we estimate that the 47 parking spaces that are being occupied are probably reducing revenues by around $140,000 a year for the city. Those permits for outdoor dining, right now the way we structured it is it will continue until May 31st at the earliest. It could go longer if the city chooses to extend it. We're currently in the red tier, and we may be moving into orange relatively soon. And when we get into orange and yellow, restaurants can increase their capacity indoors up to 50%. At this point, we don't know how long the blue term will be in place. Old hunch is that we'll continue to have some levels of restrictions as we get into the early summer, but maybe by the time we get into later summer, that's when potentially this system blueprint potentially goes away. No guarantee, though, it's not under my control for sure. In 2016, the city actually took a stab at an outdoor dining program. It was a 2-year pilot program that the city council adopted. The basic idea behind it was for a limited part of the village, a couple parklets could be allowed for a 2-year period to see how they worked out. What ended up happening was the total cost to apply for one of these was in the vicinity of almost $5,000. The rents that we put in place in that program were $3,000 per parking space per year. And then the construction costs, because we were requiring effectively a deck to be built, it was around $7,000 to $15,000. But it was a business that was interested, but they ended up pulling out during that second year because they really realized they were not going to be able to be put there, potentially $15,000 to $20,000 in sub cost at the outset over a relatively short period of time. So at this point, the village parklet pilot program is expired, and we don't have any sort of mechanism by which any of the businesses that had our providing today could move forward when the emergency order expires. Parking meter rates. Parking meter rates were last changed in 2009, when they went from $1 to $1.50 per hour. The process was a pretty, was right around the time that I first came to the city, but it was a relatively in-depth process that included a comprehensive city study of the village parking rates, village parking, formation of a blue ribbon commission, and that multiple times, ultimately came up with recommendations and then multiple city council hearings. In addition to the village parking meter rates, we also have employee parking permit programs, which cost a certain amount of money, resident parking permits, and then also overnight accommodations like the hotels in the village. They can purchase transferable passes that they can give out to their guests. So when we talk about sort of the village parking rate structure, potentially all of those items could be on the table if we want to work with them. So that takes us to options for how to move forward. I think that there's really three different paths the council could direct staff to pursue. One is really to develop a long-term plan for the outdoor dining, focusing on that. I think council would want to consider the lost parking revenue as we develop what that long-term plan looked like, whether the consideration of parking revenue ultimately led to kind of a one-for-one match, like the original program, would remain to be seen, could be decided down the road. But I do think the city would want to consider at least, looking at, okay, if we're going to do this, what's the financial implications of the city? Another option, which is sort of the half blending these two different projects together, would be looking at outdoor dining, but then also looking at maybe some of the other parking rate rates in the village and maybe don't generate much community concern. I think in general, most community concerns around the village parking meter rates. But for example, you know, potentially we could look at tweaking the rates at the City Hall parking lots behind City Hall, or maybe one of our other programs, one of the things that didn't generate as much community concern. The disadvantage of this approach is that the parking meter rates are set by, well, they're set, they're subject to Coastal Commission approval. So we would end up having to submit to Coastal Commission twice. In addition, you know, I think that there's a pretty strong argument that there's a relationship between how much you're charging in the village versus how much we're charging in the remote lots. Maybe it could look like we're piecemealing the project. The third option is really to say, look, we're going to do both. This would be a big effort. It probably would be something that would occupy a lot of the work for the city for the next year. And it would be basically looking at a long-term plan for outdoor parking and tackling the village parking rates. The downside of that is that sometimes, you know, when you put too many things on the plate, nothing gets done. And so I think that's my only concern with this approach is that are we tackling too much at once, creating more than we can get done? So with that, that concludes my presentation. I'm available for questions.
Thank you. I'm just wondering if staff has done any estimated, any revenue estimates for if either the village meters or the parking lot fees were to go up by a quarter or 50 cents or a dollar. Has there been any estimates of what kind of revenue that would bring in if the parking rates were increased?
Does that. I will tell you though that it's, you know, we would probably mostly just straight line it. So I do think that our finance director could give us, our public works director could give us a ballpark figure on our total meter rates. And then hypothetically, if we were to go from $1.50 to $2 an hour, that's a 33% increase. So we could come up with that pretty quickly if you want.
Okay, thank you.
Councilmember Kaiser.
Thank you. I think this might be a question more towards Katie, but I'm kind of thinking a little bit outside of the village at this point. I know a lot of things are put on the parklets that are taking up cost to the city, but what about other restaurants and places that are using their own parking lots to use tents or outdoor dining for this same thing that would limit their parking that then again is part of their lease or whatever their property ownership is based on whatever business that they're running? Is there any way to compare these two, or I don't know, I think I'm at a loss for words how to compare like the village versus say somewhere on 41st that may have their own parking lot, they're allowed to use the parking spaces but isn't being taxed on our parking dollars, so they're scot free and the village business is not.
Let me take a stab at it, Katie, and then maybe you could jump in and help me out here if I'm stumbling. So I think that there's two parts to your question. I think the first part is, you know, are we focusing in this idea of outdoor dining on the village? And I'll be honest with you, that's kind of the way I conceptualized it. But I think you bring up a good point is, would we want to also think about continuing the opportunity for restaurants that are outside the village to use their own parking lots for outdoor dining? And I think that that's a good question. I think that could easily be folded into this overall objective for the goal so that we can look into that. And I think you're also pointing out another good point is that the rules we would set up around that, really what the purpose for their parking on their lot that they're paying for is to minimize the impacts on their neighbors from their business, right? So that their business doesn't end up spilling over and impacting their neighbors. So it'd be a whole different sort of set of, I think, rules or a kind of program that we would set up than if we're giving up public space, right? If we're giving up public parking spaces on a public asset for private business. So I think that could make sense. I'll be honest with you, I was kind of mentally more focused on the village because it's right in front of us, but I think that's a good point.
No, and thank you. This kind of just stemmed right now, so I just wanted to put it out there because if I don't, then I'll forget about it. But yeah, I just think if we're going to continue on a long-term thing, I think it's a great thing to incorporate and think about as far as not singling out just the village and just 41st or wherever, but kind of making it, yeah, and things may be different depending on your location, but maybe sort of factoring some of that stuff in too. Thank you.
Vice Mayor Story, do you have a question?
I did, thank you. Jamie, in the staff report, it mentions that changing the parking rates would require coastal commission approval. It's an amendment to our local coastal plan. However, was setting up the parklets, which would also eliminate parking spaces, also the subject of a change in our local coastal plan, subject to coastal commission approval?
Believe it would be in the same way. My understanding, because they were okay with our pilot program, was that as long as we were issuing coastal development permits for the projects, they were okay with us proceeding without an LCP amendment for that pilot program. However, it's possible that if we were to implement something larger, that they would suggest that it's an LCP amendment and it isn't just the issuance of a coastal development permit. So I think that if this becomes a goal, Steve Jesberg and myself have spoken a little bit and we've identified a number of different kind of immediate research needs, and that is one of them, is to talk to Coastal Commission and get clear about their position around the outdoor line.
Okay, thank you.
Okay, seeing no other questions, we'll go ahead and do this to public comments. Do we have any comments or questions from the public?
Yes, Mayor Brooks, I see one attendee with a hand up, although I'm trying, oh, there it is. Okay, let me allow, it's Linda Smith.
Good evening, Council. Can you hear me now? Good evening.
Hear you, Ms. Smith.
Good evening, Mayor Brooks and council members and Jamie as well. First, I want to commend you for your quick and decisive action throughout this pandemic and for allowing me the opportunity to speak and for having these presentation materials put together for this issue tonight, because it's been one of those things that's been on my mind for a couple of months now. I was a planning commissioner when we originally sort of deliberated the parklet idea, and safety, size, and image were focus areas for us then. And now, because of what's happened with the pandemic, we have some real life examples that can help mitigate some of those concerns that we had before. Traffic has slowed, especially in the Esplanade. Pedestrian awareness by vehicles has increased with the parklets being there. Adequately spaced parklets require more than two spaces, and I think we can see that now in the implementation that we've got. Once they were invested with lights and plants and planters, after you guys said that this would go at least until the end of May, I think that the parklets really brought some charm and some vibrancy to the village that we didn't have before, because the only place for all of the crowds to go were the sidewalks and the seawall and, of course, the beach. But now there are gathering places that are helping the restaurants and at the same time distributing some of that crowd and changing the nature of the experience in the village. And it's good. I think the restaurants are going to have continued challenges. Right now, getting staff to come back is a huge deal for most of the restaurants in the area, both in Capitola and outside of Capitola. 50% occupancy is a lot more than we have today, but most restaurants are limited more by the 6-foot required spacing than they are the number of 25% versus 50%. And the restaurant owners that I talk to say it's not going to help them going from 25 to 50% if they have to give up the outdoor dining seats that they now have available. Mr. Westman said it very well when he said, the successful restaurant of the future will provide sufficient square footage, spacing, and protected separation, air handling equipment, and modern kitchens to ensure a safe dining experience for both customers and staff. I think he's absolutely right about that, but what better air management system can you have than being outdoors at the beach? Requiring infrastructure investments, raised platforms, new kitchens, all of that, while being the house. Seat space. Am I running out of time?
You are, Miss.
Can I just really close really quickly? I really encourage you to adopt option one and in haste. And develop a long-term strategy that minimizes the immediate burden on the restaurants with a phased investment approach. Identify those design elements that are really important, like lighting and borders and that kind of thing, but allow flexibility so that each area can uniquely identify itself. Extend the May 31st deadline to provide adequate time for the restaurants to respond to what you come up with, and give them a real reason to invest. Today we have a variety of dining in Capitola that encourages people of all ethnic, cultural, and economic levels to mingle together outdoors at the beach. And I think that's what the Coastal Commission really strives for. So it's gotta be worth 47 parking spaces to them since we have the big parking lots. And I'm sure the city can recover its loss in revenue in the rents for those parklets. Thank you for listening to me.
Thank you. Okay, so now we'll bring it back to council for further discussion, some direction for staff, and a vote. Councilmember Kaiser.
Thanks again. I'm talking about this, but I just want to thank Linda for her points. I resonate with a lot of them. I do think that coming up with some type of symbiotic relationship for city and small business is important. However, I do think, as Mr. Westman stated, that we are approaching a new normal, so that we are no longer going to be elbow to elbow within doors of a dining experience, so that the outdoor possibility should be kind of in the forefront. And whether we also talk to other businesses that are not dining, that I think going to the BIA and getting more information on this is how we can move forward as far as sort of surveying what's going to work for the village and beyond, whether that's 41st and other areas like that. So I really want to move forward with this and make it a goal and a priority to make it sustainable for both small businesses and the city and the likes and the visitors. And I appreciate that. Thanks, guys.
Thank you, Councilmember. Vice Mayor Storrick.
Thank you, Mayor Brooks. I just want to acknowledge, I think that we should be, you know, prepared, and I agree that we're probably going to have to extend this, our current outdoor dining permits beyond May 31st, because it appears that, you know, the blueprint and the tiers are probably going to continue longer. And I don't think it's in anyone's interest to for us, for the restaurants and for the city to try to survive on 50% occupancy. I think as part of this analysis, it would be interesting to see what that capacity means in terms of either reduced or additional sales tax revenue for the city, because I think that would be critical in this analysis. And going beyond that, I guess I have one concern I have, because we've had prior experience with the parklets and the expense involved. And, you know, when you took the cost of the improvements, the cost of the permit, and then the cost of the annual rental to the city, it was approaching almost $20,000. And so I guess I have a concern whether many of the businesses are going to be able to afford that. And particularly, you know, the annual grants that would be that we attempted to collect, which was about $3,000 a year, and which it appears that it would be about that same amount. So if there was some ability to offset the loss to the city, because if we don't collect those rents, the city is going to lose revenue. But if we impose those rents to keep the city whole, it may be too expensive for the businesses to participate. So I think we need to try to solve that dilemma. And I agree with Councilwoman Kaiser that going long term, we need to take our time and bring in all the stakeholders, because this would be a significant wholesale change to the village, to the, you know, traffic circulation, and the, you know, the visitor experience. So I think it is something that we should take our time with and evaluate. And I anticipate that it's going to require Coastal Commission approval to have, you know, permanent parklets in the village after we have exited the blueprint. Those are my thoughts. I'm glad that we're looking at this and studying it. I think we should continue to do so, but I think we should try to find a formula that's going to work for everyone concerned. Thank you.
Thank you, Vice Mayor. I just want some clarification on the item before us this evening, or maybe offer some clarity. From what I understand, tonight's item is just to set this as a goal for the next, and Jamie, help me if I'm wrong, for this next coming year, and that in May, we'll be revisiting the program itself. And so I'm just hoping that the feedback you're receiving tonight could be included in the May presentation, because there's a lot of great ideas and suggestions being brought forward. But am I mistaken, tonight just for us to say yes, we're going to look at parklet altogether, and we want to set that as a council goal? I just can you offer some clarification and reframe what you're looking for tonight?
Thank you, Mayor Brooks. Yeah, tonight what we're looking for really is if the council wants to give us direction about which one of these three goals or a modified version thereof is a fiscal year 21-22 goal. And you're exactly right. I think actually our goal is to get back in front of the city council with the first, because of the timing of the outdoor dining, if we do determine that outdoor dining is goal for next year, which I think we are, then we're going to do our best to get back to the council to actually start talking about the issue and bringing information in April, hopefully before May, if possible. So yeah, so my if I had my brothers at this point, we would see a motion saying, you know, I moved the legal board with option, one of the options listed here, or a different version.
Okay, thank you. Before I move on to Councilmember Peterson, Vice Mayor Story, I still see your hand up. Are you done with your comments?
I am, but just hearing that, I guess I would want to put in there that I support option two. Thank you.
Okay, thank you, Councilmember Peterson.
To clarify if that was a motion or just a comment?
Just a comment, not a motion.
Okay, thank you. I also, as Vice Mayor Story mentioned, I also have concerns about the costs that we previously had in place for parklets, and that may deter some businesses from using them going forward, especially since we've seen the benefit they can bring to our village. I would like to see in the future, when this comes back to us in April, those kind of cost estimates of what kind of revenue the city could bring in if our village parking meter prices went up, either from $150 to $175 or to $2. And then also what kind of revenue estimates we could see in our parking lots if those prices were to be increased as well. And then in general, I also want to echo the comments that Councilwoman Kaiser mentioned about bringing in all the stakeholders for this issue. And finally, I would like to make a motion to move forward with option one in establishing a long-term outdoor dining strategy quickly in the near term, and then agreeing to evaluate the parking rates. It says in future years, but I would just say subsequent to the parklet issue, although, you know, if we could bring back the information about the park, the rates, I think that would help us make better decisions about the outdoor dining strategy, and then we could actually dive in deeper with the parking issue at a later time. Was that a clear motion? I'm not sure that it was.
I think we had a pretty clear motion. It was option one, if not with a commitment to look at the parking rates subsequent to getting the outdoor parking, outdoor dining time.
Yes.
Councilmember Kaiser?
Yeah, I want to second that in a way, and forgive me. I think I'm coming across the point where I don't really want our village parking rates to impede on how we move forward with the parklets. And so maybe I'm missing the difference between option one and option two, if that just means we could focus on the parking of the back lots versus the parking of the village lots, or if in future years we focus on the village, that's cool too, and I can totally second that, and I'm down. Thanks.
Are you asking for clarification on my motion or on the staff recommendation?
I think the recommendation.
Oh, okay.
Difference in the staff recommendation was option one was really focusing on getting the outdoor dining done, and then option two was focusing on getting the outdoor dining done, but maybe if there is any low-hanging fruit, and I'm not sure if that's really a good term in this context, but maybe looking at the remote lots, the rates in the remote lots, probably. That's probably the only area of non-controversial parking rates that I can think of. So that's the difference between one and two.
Okay, so I feel like I'm siding with two then, but.
Okay. Okay, so we have a motion on the table for staff recommendation one. Do we have a second? Okay, seeing none.
My second.
Okay, so. Okay, so Councilmember Bertrand, you would like option one?
Yes.
Okay. So we have a first and a second. Any further conversation?
Yes, I have a question of staff.
Oh, I'm sorry, Councilmember Bertrand. Vice Mayor Story's hand was raised first.
I'm happy to defer to Councilman Bertrand.
Okay, yeah. Councilmember Bertrand.
So, City Manager, I think you addressed this, but I just want to be clear. You are ready to run with this so that we have clear direction. We're going to be working with other groups and help that formulate our direction. And we'll be able to address this way in advance of the May deadline.
Way in advance, I think it's going to be a real push. Our goal is to get information to start the process with the council next month. And do our best to have a program in place before the end of May. But I think, as a council member, or Vice Mayor Story said previously, it's very likely that I think we're going to be extending our temporary outdoor dining program into June. And I also do know that the car show was recently canceled for this next year. So that conflict at the beginning of June has gone away. So
okay.
We'll do our best, but I don't want to promise that we're going to have the whole thing buttoned up by the end of May.
Okay, so you brought up my concern. I'm supporting one, but at some point, if you need more time, we could just put in before the City Council to extend that deadline.
Yeah, I do think that that would be necessary.
Okay, thank you.
Okay, Vice Mayor Story.
Yeah, thanks again, Mayor Brooks. I guess I wanted just to ask about clarification on the motion. The staff report says the option one is to establish a long-term strategy for outdoor dining. But what I'm hearing, it sounds like, and maybe clarification on the motion is to establish and implement long-term dining. Is that accurate?
Well, if I'm understanding correctly the overall issue, that my motion would be to establish a strategy for long-term dining, but because we need to make a decision by May 31st, that we would need to implement that strategy before that time. Or at least extend the what we have happening now would at least need to extend past May 31st. I'm fine with that. And then in that case, my motion would be just to create a strategy. So maybe I just caused more confusion based on the question.
Like nothing would change. If we vote on this tonight, nothing's going to change until we vote again.
That's my understanding.
Okay.
Yeah. All we're doing at this point is saying whether or not we want to tackle the parking meters next year and outdoor dining, or whether we're going to focus on outdoor dining. I think that's the simplest way to think of the two options.
Okay.
Okay, so we're just setting a goal tonight to bring back outdoor dining again at a later meeting. We're just setting the goal, adding it to the roster of items that we did at our last meeting. And I have a motion on the table for option one, which is to establish this as a goal for 2022. That's the year. So we're going to establish that as a goal. We're going to bring it back for further discussion and more great ideas for Foster about outdoor dining in the future. But this option one is very specific about the parking option. And so we have a first and a second by Councilmember Bertrand. Are we ready for roll call?
May I have a follow-up question, Mayor Brooks?
Sure, Vice Mayor.
Because I wanted to ask staff, as a part of option one, do you think you can develop a strategy that's going to be revenue neutral for the city?
I think I can develop a strategy that's going to be revenue neutral for the city. What we'll do is we'll look at probably added revenue that we could get out the outdoor dining, and then also look at what the rents would be. I know this is a little bit off topic, but I don't think that the hang up to our pilot program was this annual rent. I think it was the upfront cost and the limited term. So I suspect that maybe, especially if we phase in the rents, I suspect that we will be able to make it revenue neutral just on the face of it with the rents that we would charge. But we're gonna need to do some of our homework. We're gonna need to do some outreach. We're gonna need to think about how the costs to develop the improvements would be funded. All of those things.
Okay, thank you, Jenny.
And so I'll just share before we go to roll call, that is why I'm not gonna be supporting the motion on the table tonight or right now, because I believe we're gonna have to look at other options and the possibility of increasing the parking in our Lower Patco or our those two other parkings might be able to help mitigate those costs. That we're talking about, that Vice Mayor was talking about. So that's why I'm in favor of option two, and that's why I won't be voting yes for the motion on the table this evening. So I'm going to take it to roll call and then go for, Council Member Kaiser, I'm sorry.
No, thank you. I think you put it better than I did. I'm trying to look at both sides of the coin here, and I'm feeling a lot of pushback from the public as far as the outdoor dining, you know, costing us revenue and things like that. So if this is something that we want to continue, which I think we all are in agreement that we should, especially for our small businesses, that is there another supplemental income that we can look at in conjunction with the continuation of the way things are going for the parklets, i.e., the back parking lots, and look at that situation as far as upping the hourly costs or whatever to supplement and to kind of try to bring up the scales here and make it so that more people are comfortable in the community with how it's going on. So it's not just like the restaurants are just getting all that they want and we're losing money and whatever, which I want things to, I want it to be more symbiotic. And so I think that's all I'm trying to get at is, I think it's a little less black and white than the 1-2-3 scale that we're looking at.
Councilmember Peterson?
Thank you. I just wanted one more point of clarification from staff, if I could. So if my motion to, my motion's been made clear on option one, but I have a question on option two. If we were to go forward with that, that means that we would need Coastal Commission approval. And so any long-term strategy we did come up with for the parklets could not be implemented until Coastal Commission approves any kind of changes in lot fees if we were to decide that. Is that correct? So we'd have to go forward with the kind of temporary measure we have now, potentially for 6 months to a year or more, however long it takes for Coastal Commission to approve our parking lot changes. Is that correct?
I don't know whether or not, at this point, I just can't tell you whether or not the changes in the LCP that the parking meters would necessitate would also hold up the outdoor dining. You're correct that even if we started moving today and said we wanted to change the meter rates in the back lots, it would take at least 6 months before that change could come and take place. But right. I don't know if that would slow down the implementation of the outdoor dining.
So that would depend on us as a council, though, correct? If we as a council said, yes, we will allow this long-term strategy for parklets to go forward if and when we can increase the parking meter rates, then we as a council are essentially determining how long that would take. Is that correct?
Correct.
I'm sorry, Jamie, you cut out just a little bit at the end of the last
yes,
part.
That's correct. Then you'd be tying the two projects together.
Okay, cool. That's all I needed. Thank you so much.
Yeah, just a little bit on that point. From my sense is that option two incorporates option one, and it's always at our discretion to determine what the final plan is going to be. And this just gives us an opportunity to evaluate the meter rates in the lots, to see if we could use that in some way to offset the cost of the permits, the annual fees, and for the businesses. So I didn't view that option two as necessarily restricting option one in any way. It just, to me, it spans our possibilities of consideration. And also having the specifics or the confirmation of what the Coastal Commission is going to require will also weigh into our ultimate decision. So that's just my sense of it. It gives us a greater, I think, platform to work from, and we may very well end up at option one or that one being implemented until such time as we can change the meter rate. So, I mean, that was my sense of it. You know, if staff feels that's the wrong interpretation, yeah, please, you know, let me know. But to me, that I didn't think that they were in, you know, we were committed and tied to those two things when it came back to us. Thank you.
Gosh, I hope not, Vice Mayor Story, because I'm with both of you, Councilmember Peterson and Vice Mayor Story, about all, looking at all options. Okay, I see Councilmember Bertrand is back. So, any other comments before I move to roll call? Okay. Can I have a roll call, please?
Yes. Councilmember Bertrand.
Approved.
Councilmember Kaiser.
Aye.
Councilmember Peterson.
Aye.
Vice Mayor Story.
I'm the option two guy, so no.
Mayor Brooks.
No. Okay. All right. I think the movement from Mr. Lorenz, we're moving on to item 8C, consider options for implicit bias training.
Yes. Good evening, Mayor Brooks, council members. I'm trying to share the screen on the correct one for the broadcast. So one second, while I make sure I get this right. Okay. Hope everyone can see that. So I'm here for you to talk about implicit and unconscious bias training. This was a goal established by the council to provide implicit or unconscious bias training for council members and staff. We have researched different options and we kind of categorize the options based on the roles and responsibilities of the type of training. So we've kind of separated out city council, department heads, and those others who attend the council meetings on a regular basis, the Capitol Police, community service, and parking enforcement officers, and then the other city Capitol employees, kind of the rank and file employees up at City Hall as well as up at the Public Works Yard. So the first option we kind of considered is a public workshop for the city council and department heads. It would be a public workshop, of course, at this point be conducted over Zoom. We've talked to a few professional bias trainers. I will tell you up front that a few of the people we've talked to will not do this in a public meeting setting due to the fact that the content is their livelihood, and they're not willing to do it in a public meeting. But we have talked to a couple that we think are going to be would be pretty good. They both talked to about 90 minutes in length. If the council would like, it could be a joint council and planning commission meeting.
Again, it's a public meeting, so everybody, the public, other staff, anyone can watch it as well. And if this is the direction the council desires, staff would work with the council to select a date and time for this public workshop. And we go down to the Capitol Police Department as well as the community service officers. Currently, police officers are required to pass an implicit bias training as part of the police academy. In addition, there's an 8-hour bias and racial profiling course that they need to pass every 5 years. And that includes sworn officers in the city of Capitola. It includes sworn officers, community service officers, as well as parking enforcement officers. The city does have the ability to increase this training frequency if that's the direction. As far as other city employees, we were looking at a self-directed e-learning. At this point, we're looking one put done by one of the same groups that does the public workshop. It is an organization that does implicit bias training all over the world. In addition, you know, if employees want to, they can attend the city council workshop whenever that's decided to be. So at this point, what we're hoping for is some direction. The recommended action is for the city council and department heads to hold a public meeting, continue with the 8-hour implicit bias training for the police department and the community service officers. And then for other employees, allow access to self-directed e-learning. And I believe that is the end, and I'm available for any questions on this item.
Okay, I'm gonna move to council for questions. Council Member Peterson.
Thank you. So I know that you mentioned that the police and community service officers are required to do this every 5 years. I know that council members were required to take a harassment training. I think it's every 4 years. So I'm wondering if with the implicit bias training, if staff is given any consideration to how often this would be required, or if there's a recommendation that this be one and done, or if this be renewed at every term, and if there's any consideration of that can be shared with the council.
I don't think we've considered the how often it's done, because this will be the first time, and you are right. All city staff has to pass anti-harassment training every 2 years, as well as the council. We have not at this point considered, because we haven't done it. And we want to see, you know, how effective it is the first time, and to see, I mean, if the direction is to figure out a way to do this on a regular basis, absolutely. But we're still kind of, it isn't a structured type of training like the anti-harassment. Every trainer has a different way of going about this. So there's no kind of defined structure. So we'd like to figure out, you know, if at least the first go around, if it's successful, if it's meeting the goals that we want, and then we can kind of address that after we kind of get through the first cycle of this.
Cool, thank you.
Mm-hmm. Vice Mayor Story.
Thank you, Mayor Brooks. Larry, I was a little unclear. You'd said that for the public workshops, that some of the facilitators were not willing to do it publicly, yet, you know, the council meeting, the planning commission meeting are required to be public. So how do we reconcile that?
Well, I was just trying to say, we have found some that are willing to do it. Not all of them are. We've had people that denied, because that's their intellectual property. You know, they figured if it's out there, what we have agreed to is it wouldn't be recorded like a regular meeting. And that's kind of, but that was the concern, is that it is what they sell to other folks. And if they have it on if it's part of a public meeting, it's going to be there, and they're not going to be able to do that.
Okay. So that would just limit our options.
Yes. Yes. But again, we have found a couple that we think would work, if that's the direction.
Thank you.
Councilmember Bertrand.
So Larry, following up on your comments, so I guess we would consider this as a special meeting.
That's correct.
Okay, so just do this, and perhaps include city planning and others on staff if they wanted to come.
Yeah, you could make this a joint planning commission city council meeting if you'd like, and then the planning commissioners would attend. And of course, even if you don't do that, they can attend as attendee and watch, but they wouldn't be kind of the participant side of things.
Thank you.
Any other questions? Okay, I have a question. So I'm guessing there has been conversation by the police officers around the police officer standards training. I know that they've been discussing changing the timeline, the requirements from 5 years to more often. Do we know if there's been any decisions made, or if there's been any talk about changing that in the near future? I see Chief McManus, you turned your screen on.
Good evening, Mayor.
Would you like to answer that? Hi, nice to see you.
If I may, good evening, Mayor and council members. You are correct. In the 2019 legislative session, there was a bill on the floor that if passed, it would have required this same mandated 8-hour implicit bias training on a 2-year cycle rather than the current 5-year cycle. That bill back in 2019 died on the floor, but post Cal Chiefs and other groups are of the opinion that it will likely come forward again at some point in the legislative session, and there may be a different result.
Thank you very much. Any other questions from council? Okay, we can move this to public comment. Do we have any comments from the public?
Yes, first hand up, Mayor Brooks, is Linda Smith.
Welcome back, Ms. Smith.
So you can hear me?
I can.
Okay. I'll be quicker this time. So in the private sector, I'm very familiar with the reality that you can't change a corporate culture without doing it company-wide. And it can't happen without leadership from the top. Because of schedule conflicts, I've only been able to attend one of the community meetings on equity, but I found it very thought-provoking
And racism, like sexism, is sometimes a subtle thing, sometimes not so subtle. Just like bias is a cultural thing sometimes, and sometimes just an individual. Terms like unearned privilege and systemic racism can evoke an immediate reaction in those of us who have witnessed overt racism and thought it died with laws intended to provide equality. I have the utmost respect for our police department, our city staff, and our city leadership. Mandatory training of this kind is a bold step forward, and I salute you for considering it, and I support spending money to achieve it. Thank you.
Thank you, Ms. Smith. Do we have any other comments from the public?
Yes, we do, Mayor Brooks. Amy Forrest.
Thank you.
Welcome, Forrest.
Mayor, hi, and thank you to the City Council, and thank you to Linda Smith for what she just said. Right on, Linda. We wrote a letter that I would like to read. My husband Carl and I wrote a letter that I'd like to read into record. So we take issue with the current agenda language in the item 8C as it's currently written. The recommendation includes three facets of implicit bias training. One, holding a public workshop for council and department heads. Two, 8 hours of already required training for police in a 5-year cycle. And three, access to online professional development for city staff. As for the public workshops for the council, the rules and the nature of public hearing make it not a place for people to explore implicit bias in a safe setting, which is what you really need. Routine police professional development taken every 5 years may address a timely issue like bias and racism in policing, but we have to wonder about needed follow-up work. And if the police department's under public fire for racism now across the nation, use the same system as we use in Capitola. And finally, non-mandatory online professional development for staff on their isolated computers will probably not address the deep issues that are needed and probably won't change behavior, unfortunately. Work on implicit bias and racism requires hard, long-term, systematic work in a safe space where participants can build trust in order to open up and explore very deep personal and cultural issues. Working together with mentors and experts in the field is required for effective work in exploring bias. In our opinion, and from our experience, the current recommendation, as it's described in item 8C, will not be as effective as we need, and is unfortunately kind of written in a biased manner. We recommend instead contact you have talked to organizations, but we'd like to make sure you check out lots of different organizations that do really important work. Carl has had experience with Courageous Conversations in a business setting before and got a lot out of it. And get input on systematic programs that involve the entire Capitola City government, members and staff. Find out its cost, and then decide on a designated time. You could also contact other government agencies in our region to collaborate and either join them on work that is already in motion or propose the creation of a consortium to find a strong, long-term program at a better cost within a definite time frame. And if quick decisions due to budgeting are needed, some quick phone calls or emails to those groups described above could ballpark an amount that should be for budget professional development that the council prefers. Bottom line, Capitola City government should be diving into professional development around implicit bias as soon as possible, with a focus on personal exploration and then policy considerations. Deep work and understanding must start with each individual. Then, with that understanding and education, learning can be applied to citywide issues. But addressing bias should be done in a way that is meaningful and is not simply a way to use unearned privilege and recommendations with little meaning that serve to specifically not make the deep changes that are required to address implicit bias in government and in our community. In our opinion, the way agenda item 8C is written is in a way to promote inaction and not address bias. It's not enough. This critical topic and deep study does need to be more carefully researched and acted upon by you, our Capitola City Council. Thanks so much.
Thank you. Okay, we're gonna bring this back to council for further discussion and a vote.
Thank you.
Do we have any comments from council to start with? Okay, Council Member Bertrand?
Yeah, I reflected on Amy and Carl's letter. I know them and respect their community participation. Know they've done a lot of things, they're very community oriented. And so I took their comments very seriously. The problem I was having is what would work such that, in a sense, a meaningful course or a meaningful way to deal with this issue for a public body. We're not a corporation, you know, Linda, you know, I know what Linda's talking about because I've been through a lot of those kinds of meetings and day seminars and weekend seminars in my private setting, but we're not. We're a public organization and we don't work together on a daily basis. We see each other every 2 weeks. I mean, so I don't know what would accomplish what Amy is talking about. I think the effort that we're trying to do is a really worthwhile effort, but how do we actually do it? And, maybe we can consider other things. So maybe it's not a one-off. I found that the courses I've taken in this regard, seminars and stuff, you start thinking about things. And so, you know, if there's follow-up, so if we go to someone that does something, you know, for I don't know how long we're considering, and then we do another special session in a month or 2 months or something like that, you know, things are going to come up that maybe follow-up events or seminars or public meetings would be really helpful for us. That's all. So not a one-off, you know, make a more serious effort. And I think that would get more to the point with what our public comments are talking about. And I think more to the point of what this whole effort was from the beginning. So Yvette, I think you brought this up and I think it was a great idea at the time. So we want to do something that is more meaningful. And I think Amy's comments brought up something that made me really think about it. So those are my comments.
Thank you, Councilmember. Councilmember Peterson?
Thank you. I just have a question about the city employees, the other city employees aspect. It says they'll have access to a self-directed e-learning plan. Does that mean it's not required or mandatory? It's just, here it is if you want to take it?
At this point, during the discussions, there was some questions one way or the other. We hadn't made that decision yet. If the council can direct either way, either way is an option.
Okay, I think it would be important for this to be something that's required of our staff and really all people that are dealing with the public, the planning commission, the city council, because I think part of the whole point behind implicit bias is, you know, it's bias that we don't recognize that we have and maybe part of our decision-making process. And so we're dealing with issuing permits or approving plans or passing legislation, local legislation. I think it's important that we have these kinds of trainings that help us to consider those things. That's my comments on that item for now. Thank you.
Okay. So, you know, I'd just like to add this was something that I brought forward and it's really important to me. This whole idea of implicit bias training, it's most certainly not a fad. It's not something
that goes away are the, our actions and what we've talked about and what we're seeing going on throughout the country is most certainly in respect to racism or in regards to racism isn't the way people are behaving. This is not just an offshoot thing. This is a real problem. It's a problem in our community, and it's most certainly really important for us to address this. And this is why I think it's important at the city level for us to do something about it. And these steps most certainly get us in the right direction. So to answer Mr. Lorentz's questions about when, you know, I think that all city staff, all council members and commissioners, and all police officers should be on a 2-year cycle for implicit bias training. Now, if the POST from the Police Officers Association come back with something different or less than 2 years, then we could address that at that time to, and also, like I said, this isn't a fad. This isn't like a one-time thing that council prioritizes for the year. I think that we need to see these trainings happen when I'm long and gone and the rest of us have moved forward. We need to continue these trainings. And so I think it's important that this be a priority from here on out. And it may be called something different, that, you know, there might be a different type of training later on down the road. But I think we really need to focus on this and dedicate our time and energy towards this. So 2-year cycle for all staff, all council members, all commissioners, and to make this something that's on an ongoing. To Council Member Bertrand's point about, you know, and to what our speaker said, it is hard to have these raw conversations. And I know that councils have the opportunity to go on retreat. You know, we can do it via Zoom or whatever that may look like, but I know there's different options out there. And I know that staff could look into that a little bit further on how we can make it more feasible and more comfortable for us to have those open dialogue, more open dialogue. So that's my comments for now. I'm not sure if I see Council Member Bertrand's hand raised. Do you have any other comments?
Yeah, I don't want to extend this too much further, but you know, Kristen had me think about an issue that I've been thinking about ever since I've been on the City Council, and even before when I was treasurer, and the whole idea of the issue related to R1 zoning and the issue that came up a long time ago when we had a different person in community development about parklets, not parklets, but ADUs, stuff like that. And I've gone through a lot of different changes in how I think about this. And, you know, a lot of it is basically because, you know, I walk around the city and I talk to a lot of people here and I see what our community is like. And my view of something beforehand didn't always coincide with the views of other people in my community. And that was a bias. And I totally fess up to that. But as I saw the benefits of being more inclusive of different views of how to live and what makes a community, I changed. And, you know, I'm certainly a supporter of you know, different ways of dealing with housing people, not necessarily all R1, and granny units. You know, it's expanded quite a bit, but that's just one example, and that goes across not only the people who would vote on something when it's a zoning change, but it would also go to the level of our zoning planners when they're trying to figure out what work. So those are my comments.
Thank you, Commissioner. Okay, so it looks like staff is looking for to improve the staff recommendations. So I'm going to see if there's any other comments. I know that, Larry, you were looking for a little bit more. Well, I think I've heard council say they need a little bit more information on how, you know, is it a one-time training? What were some of those things, some of those people that you asked for? What did those programs look like? I don't know if that needs to be addressed at council or brought back to us in terms of, or if we're comfortable, council, and you can kind of let me know if we're comfortable just with stating that it should be required and how often, and then let staff go from there. I'd like some feedback from council on if we want to. Councilmember Peterson?
Yeah, I'm wondering, well, for one, I think one of the things that I would like to recommend is that this be a mandatory training, that this not be an optional training. Also that it be required for at least for council members and planning commissioners when they take office. And every time they are reelected or reappointed, so every 4 years, every term at least, in the same sense that our harassment training is required. And then that it also be required of the city employees for the same cycle at least every 4 years. And then, admittedly, I don't know enough about the police department training and if it's similar to the one we would be requiring every 4 years of staff or not. I think it's important that they have this training, and it sounds like there probably is going to be future state legislation that addresses this. But I think I need to know more about this. So I don't know. I'd be interested in hearing from the rest of the council what they feel comfortable with in whether or not there's comfort in moving forward with part of this recommendation or all of it, or asking for additional information. And Mayor Brooks, if you have any comments on this as well, I'd be interested in hearing it.
Yeah, I appreciate that. You know, I think what's important for me tonight is to walk away with council's agreement that this type of training is mandatory for the three groups. I think that just says a lot, and then perhaps we have to come back with more information on, how far the POST is with their training, what future trainings would look like for council in terms like of a retreat or et cetera, just more of those fillers. I think we've asked a lot of questions tonight that we don't have the answers to, but I think tonight what I'd like to walk away with is getting the consensus from council that we would like to see all of see implicit bias training as a mandatory training.
I can make a motion.
Councilmember Kaiser. Oh, okay.
If we need it.
Sure, go ahead.
Let me say it. So I'll make a motion to make the implicit bias training mandatory along our three groups. Along with maybe a little bit more background information and as far as scheduling and all that. Thanks.
If I understand the motion correctly, it's just that we require this training to be mandatory and that it'll come back to us from staff with additional information about what that training is, how often it is, all that fun stuff. Is that the motion?
Yes.
Okay. Okay, I'll second that motion.
Okay, we have a first and a second. Any other comments or staff, do you need any further clarification?
No, I think I've got what the direction is. Thank you.
Okay, so we'll go ahead and go to a roll call vote.
Councilmember Bertrand.
I agree.
Councilmember Kaiser.
Aye.
Councilmember Peterson.
Aye.
Vice Mayor Story.
Aye.
Mayor Brooks.
Aye. Okay, this item passes unanimously. Next item on the agenda is 8D. This is the Coastal Commission preliminary comments on local coastal plan zoning code updates.
Good evening, Mayor Brooks and Council. Before you tonight, I have the Coastal Commission local coastal plan update. I am having an issue with my download because the presentation is so large, so I'd like to ask Larry Laurent if he could possibly pull up my saved presentation from the Citywide Drive.
I will do that right now.
Thank you, Larry. And I'll start my introduction as we go. I've recently submitted back in December, our LCP update to the Coastal Commission, and the Coastal Commission responded with four comments that they'd like us to address, or that they're going to bring forward to their to the Coastal Commission during their review. So the purpose of this item tonight is to talk about those four amendments. I'm going to break this into two items. I'll talk about the Monarch Cove Inn in the first section, and then we'll follow up because our Vice Mayor Story will have to recuse himself from that item, and following that discussion. But first, I'll introduce the item, and I'll pause when we get to the Monarch Cove Inn for the recusal. So as you know, we're working under two zoning codes currently, the 2018 code and the 1975 code. One is applicable outside the coastal zone, the new code, and inside the coastal zone, we're waiting for Coastal Commission certification. Next slide, please. We're at the final step. We have submitted our, the City Council adopted the zoning code last year, and we have our submittal into the Coastal Commission. Next slide, please. In a perfect world, we would submit this to the Coastal Commission and they would approve it and we'd have a certified code. Can you forward? What we've received from the Coastal Commission is that they're prepared to take this forward to the Coastal Commission with an approval contingent to Capitola adopting red lines. So, they have their four changes that they've drafted. When they go to the, they'll take the four changes to their Coastal Commission, and there's three outcomes that can happen. And Larry, if you can forward. First, we could accept the Coastal Commission red lines and we'd have a certified code. Next, we can not accept their red lines and propose revisions, and we'd go back through the Planning Commission and then City Council process. And lastly, we can not accept their red lines and decide to do nothing, and then the submittal will lapse and we'll continue in the place that we are today with two codes. Next slide, please. So any questions about the Coastal Commission certification process before we step into the Monarch Cove in discussion? None? Okay.
And before Katie goes on with the Monarch Cove, since I live so close to it, I have a conflict, so I'm going to step away and come back for the discussion on the Capitola Hotel property. Thank you. Or I should say theater property. Thank you.
Thank you.
And before, Katie, we do jump in, I just would ask Samantha, our attorney, to just offer clarification on how this is going to go for the rest of this evening and how we're going to be voting in two parts. Samantha, can you just offer some clarification to council this evening before we jump into it?
Absolutely, Mayor Brooks. Thank you. So because Councilmember Story has a conflict that we're unfortunate with this item, we have staff has segmented this item consistent with the FCPC rules. And so Katie will present the portion of the item that pertains to the Monarch Cove Inn, which is the portion of the item on which Councilmember Story has a conflict. After that portion of her presentation, she'll let you know and ask if the council would like to discuss it. And then we have some language that if the council would like to take a vote to act on that portion of the letter, we can walk you through what that one would look like. And of course, if you'd like to make revisions or take any other action, we can walk you through that as well. After you're finished deliberating over and taking action on that portion of the letter, Councilmember Story will rejoin the meeting, and the full council can deliberate over and take action on the remaining portion of the letter.
Thank you very much. Okay, so moving forward.
Okay, the first topic to be discussed tonight is the Monarch Cove Inn. Next slide, please. The Monarch Cove Inn is a very large parcel located at the very end of Depot Hill, the Depot Hill neighborhood. There's actually three parcels on the property. The first one shown on the slide has the office with a carport and one bedroom. The second, which was part of the right-of-way, that is a private right-of-way, not city right-of-way, has a two-bedroom cottage on it. And thirdly, the Monarch Cove Inn is located where you see number three, which is an 11-bedroom bed and breakfast or inn. There's three changes that we proposed. In our submittal to the Coastal Commission, we submitted our general plan map, which is known as the land use map in the under our certified LCP. In our land use map, we were changing the visitor serving designation that was originally there to single family zoning with R1 with a visitor serving overlay. So in that scenario, the three lots could become single family homes, and you'll recall that the city council placed some conditions upon it being visitor serving, that they'd either have to provide nightly rental, some type of nightly rental, or dedicate an easement to a public viewpoint. Also with the land use map, we had the Coastal Commission's reaction to that was they rejected the change to R1 and they want to maintain it as visitor accommodations with a visitor serving overlay. Next, Larry. And then we made a modification to the zoning map. These kind of go hand in hand. Again, we had the R1 with the visitor serving overlay. The Coastal Commission rejected the R1 change, or they're going to recommend rejecting the R1 change and maintain it as visitor serving with a visitor serving overlay. Next, Larry. And then the zoning code itself. So I had mentioned that previously we had said it can be R1 with a visitor serving overlay, but single family will only be allowed in conjunction with overnight accommodation uses on the property or a grant of public access to a viewpoint. And the Coastal Commission is prepared to recommend prohibiting single family on the property, and they deleted our note for the overnight accommodation or grant of public access to a viewpoint. Next slide, please. So in the letter I've drafted, it provides a history of the property. This property has been in the Blodgett family since 1960. The current owner, that was Mrs. Blodgett that bought it in 1960. The current owner became a part owner in 1990 and then full ownership following that. And during the review of a project subdivision application adjacent to this, the Coastal Commission at that time changed the allowances of the land use on the property. When it previously allowed R1, it was modified to visitor serving. Also within the letter, I explained the current owners provided 31 years of visitor serving use. They'd like to retire and have the ability to have two cottages under separate ownership from the main house. The reasoning for this, and also is a retirement, but also bringing in the facts of the neighborhood impacts of visitor serving on the Depot Hill residents. As you'll recall, they moved forward with an expansion years ago, and the neighborhood was not happy with the idea of expanding, and there's been ongoing complaints about visitor serving use there as well as entertainment. And then just the public comments that we received during the zoning code update that were very much in support of this being modified back to R1. So we've requested in the letter that the Coastal Commission consider approving the draft as submitted. This evening, the recommended action is to authorize the mayor to submit the portions of staff's recommended letter to the Coastal Commission that discuss the Monarch Cove Inn. So this is where we're splitting up the two recommendations and asking for direction on the Monarch Cove Inn piece. Thank you.
Thank you. Do we have any questions from council? Okay, so you have questions. Do we have any comments from the audience?
We should have someone from the audience.
Larry, are you
there? Yeah, I'm sorry. With the share screen, it moved my controls. I apologize for that. Yes, we do have Lana and Bob of the Monarch Co.
Hi there. This is Lana and Bob.
Good evening, Mayor Brooks and the council.
And we really and truly appreciate your stance with the Coastal Commission in that it really depicts what not only we would love to see in our retirement, but also the neighborhood as well, in that, as we both know, that Monarch Cove is at the very end of a highly residential area, which makes it completely difficult to do any visitor serving whatsoever. And it's been a very difficult path for us. And I know that you've recognized that. And I'm just extremely thankful and very grateful with your fairness and your equity in this situation.
So again, we want to thank you. And I created the Monarch Cove Inn, and I'd like to retire from Monarch Cove Inn now. And so thank you very much for your support.
Thank you. Do we have any other comments from the audience?
Mayor Brooks, I do not see any other comments on this item.
Okay, we can bring this back to council for further discussion and a vote. Okay, I see no discussion. Katie, I would just like to add that in the letter itself, there's just a few editorial things. This is a letter written by with your support, but from me, and there was just a couple of things I'd like to work with you on the side. It changes none of the content or the recommendation in and of itself, but I just wanted to throw that out and make it public that to council this evening that there was just a few things that I'd like to discuss that does not change the item in and of itself. Okay, so with that being said, do I have a motion to adopt the recommended action this evening?
I'll make that motion. Well presented in the letter, too.
Just to be clear for the record, the motion is to authorize the mayor to submit the portions of staff's recommended letter to the Coastal Commission that discuss the Monarch Cove Inn.
I agree with that. Thank you.
Do we have a second?
Yeah, my apologies. I was just going back to the letter just to brush up on what it says to make sure that I'm understanding correctly what I'm seconding. If I'm understanding correctly, though, it looks like the letters. If I'm understanding correctly, it looked like the letter's indicating that we don't object to removing the R1 land use designation. Is that correct?
No, we're asking, we do object, and we'd like them to accept it as submitted.
Does not object to this proposed. So maybe I'm not understanding. Packet page 1 of... I'm sorry, go ahead, Katie.
I think you're looking at the Inn at Depot Hill. There are modifications for the Inn at Depot Hill. We're not requesting any changes to that. We're not objecting to that, possibly.
Monarch Cove Inn, Inn at Depot Hill. My apologies for the holdup here. I just want to make sure I understand.
But in terms of the Monarch Cove Inn, we'd like them to... Yep. Keep the R1 designation.
You're right. My apologies. I was looking specifically at the Inn at Depot Hill. Yep. Okay. I'll second that motion.
We have a first and a second. Can I have a roll call, please?
Yes. Councilmember Bertrand.
I agree.
Councilmember Kaiser.
Aye.
Councilmember Peterson.
Aye.
Vice Mayor Story is recused. And Mayor Brooks.
Aye.
Thank you.
Okay. Well, now, will someone call Vice Mayor Story to welcome him back, please? Oh, done. Welcome back, Vice Mayor. Okay, I'll turn this back over to Katie.
Okay. Next slide, please. Larry, can you, there we go. So next, we're gonna talk about the Inn at Depot Hill. Next slide. And as you know, the Inn at Depot Hill is located right on Monterey and Escalona. When you, you can see it right as you're leaving the rear City Hall parking lots. Next slide. We treated the Inn at Depot Hill the same as the Monarch Cove property. And basically we asked for the R1 base zone with visitor serving overlay. This influenced the land use map. Forward, please. Our zoning map, as well as, you can go one more, the zoning code. Well, the zoning code it had no impact on. So what the Coastal Commission is asking is to remove the R1 and have it be visitor serving on both maps with a visitor serving base and an overlay zone. This change is not substantial. The Inn at Depot Hill plans to continue as an inn. It's visitor serving. It'll be allowed to continue as the inn as it performs today. So it's not a substantial change. We're within the Coastal Commission letter, we're stating that the city does not object to this proposed change. Next slide. The next discussion is on the former theater site. Next slide, please. The next, for the Coastal Commission recommendation, the first was to prohibit the residential uses on the former theater site. Next. And in doing so, by prohibiting the residential on this site, it really takes away the current land use privileges that the current owner has. Right now, they could develop the site with ground floor commercial and residential above. So in the Coastal Commission letter as drafted, we're asking that they do not make this change, and they allow the current owner to be allowed to move forward with a ground floor commercial and residential above if they were to choose to come forward with an application. We go over the history of the general plan and the zoning code update and how that was a collaborative process. We had multiple boards, commissions, and the city council who worked on this and created an incentivized plan and incentivized development through increased floor area ratio and height for a future hotel, working closely with the property owner as well. So it seemed to be a win-win. As you know, the property owner came through with a conceptual review last year on this project and is interested in developing a hotel on the site. And I think that's the outcome of all that work that was done through the incentives. So we've asked the Coastal Commission to approve the draft as submitted and allow residential on the site and not take that away from the developer. And just in the event that a hotel came through that could not be mitigated, having residential on the site could allow possible like nightly rentals of residential on that site, but maybe not go as far as a hotel. Of course, visitor serving is a great use in that spot, but it would take away some other allowances, such as nightly rental, if there were a mixed use there. So next. And then lastly, the Coastal Commission brought up visual resources. So they made modifications to the descriptions of when a hotel project would come in, how we would analyze the visual resource and the views from above the hotel and different viewpoints looking towards the hotel. So they modified languages to improve the description of the bluff, the viewpoints, rooftop design mitigation. And next, Larry.
So in looking at these modifications and their red lines, the changes are not substantial, and we wouldn't object to those changes. They bring more clarity to what they've asked for and the review process there. So changes are not substantial, and we would not object to those proposed changes. So next slide. Does the City Council have any questions?
Council members, do you have any questions for staff about this portion of the letter? Council Member Bertrand.
So, you know, it's hard to say what Swenson would be planning, but if the number of the units became condos, are they considering a mix at this point, or is this units for sale? I mean, do we have any projections? Do we have any communication?
No, at this point, in regards to what we've received from the Coastal Commission, is they would not be able to bring in a condo project. That would not be allowed. So, no, they could only do a hotel on that site or another visitor serving use there, but not residential would not be allowed above the commercial.
So I sort of thought that was their position. I was just wondering what Swenson was thinking about how they would move forward with the design. And, you know, we've seen their conceptual design right now, and I don't know how that would change it. And would they have a mix, you know, that kind of thing. But we don't know anything at this point.
No, I have no additional information on that.
Yes, good way to answer it. Thanks.
Any other questions from council? Okay. Seeing no further questions, we can take it to the audience for any questions or comments from them.
Yes, Mayor Brooks, I have Jesse Bristow asking to talk.
And I'm just going to announce that we are officially opening a public hearing. Thank you for the slide.
Good evening. Can everyone hear me?
We can.
Okay. Good evening, Mayor Brooks and council members. My name is Jesse Bristow with Swenson Builders. I'm a development project manager for our Santa Cruz office. So I can speak a little bit to council member Bertrand mentioned, and we'd like to provide some comment on the letter that is being written. So we fully support the letter that staff is proposing and that city council may adopt. I think ever since Swenson has been involved with the vision of the hotel, we've worked with community in 2019, and it may have been part of 2020 where there was discussion with LCP update of who gets to decide the roof line, the measurements, the articulation, and we worked with Planning Commission, City Council with that, you know, letting that, hey, let us bring the project forward and let the community decide not to be restricted by you know, arbitrary measurements from Coastal Commission. So I think the community and us as a property owner we're aligned. So we do agree that the secondary non-significant changes being proposed are okay. But as far as the residential use, currently the general plan allows mixed use. And essentially the Coastal Commission is spot zoning and taking away that use. Again, we've always had this vision to provide a visitor serving use and have a hotel in the long term. But again, you know, it's nice to have the option and that land use right for a mixed use residential component. Referring to Councilmember Bertrand's comment, We've done some conceptual layouts for a townhome or condo concept, but again, as what Director Hurley he mentioned, is that they could be, you know, 30-day rentals, daily rentals, things like that, but still have a kind of a residential feel to it. Probably not as accommodating as a full-service hotel. So with that, we don't agree with the Coastal Commission's recommendations in that respect of taking away that land use. Again, they're kind of just selecting this one site and not focusing on the remainder of the village. And so we don't think that that's appropriate. And if there's any further questions, I'm happy to be available. So thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Bristow. Okay, any other comments from the audience?
Mayor Brooks, I do not see anyone else asking to comment on this item.
Okay, so we'll bring it back to council for further discussion and a vote. Do we have any other comments or a motion? Vice Mayor Story.
Thank you, Mayor Brooks. I just have one, the inn on Depot Hill. I agree with staff. I think those are acceptable. But just speaking about the Coastal Commission eliminating residential use on the Tuckhoe Theater site, I would agree with the last speaker that that is spot zoning and is contrary to our coastal plan. I would just as a recommendation include in the letter that the history of Capitola is about mixed use residential commercial. That's what the village is all about. It would enhance visitor serving because if our only options between us and the developer are a hotel, we may end up with just, you know, a parking lot there with no additional visitor serving use. And so I think it would be beneficial to emphasize that kind of mixed use, maybe capacities that would fit most closely in with the village in terms of compatibility. That argument. Thank you.
Thank you, Vice Mayor. I don't know if you weren't here earlier. There were some things I was going to sit down about the letter, just some editorial, some edits like that, not to the actual motion or recommendations themselves, but I also noted that as well, and can bring, I could talk with Katie about that. Thank you. Council Member Bertrand.
Yeah, thank you very much, Mayor. I detect a willingness to and a desire to go ahead with this project on Swenson's part, and it looks like you've worked with staff to come up with something that's agreeable. Yes, I would like to see a hotel there, but we couldn't come to that kind of agreement before, and maybe this is the best way to move forward. And as Sam Story mentioned, it's a disgrace just to see a parking lot there. It really is. And, you know, it's not the best use of property in the center of our village. And so if this means that we can move forward and maybe hopefully work with Coastal Commission to see our way around this, and I think the Swensons might have enough pull to help that happen, not sure. But, you know, if we can make a project there, get going, I totally support this particular proposal. Thank you.
I'm echoing. I hear myself and somebody else's computer. Okay, so no other comments. Do we have a motion to adopt staff's recommendation and to submit this letter to Coastal Commission?
I so move. Do I have to read the whole darn thing? No. Is that good enough? Thank you.
Yeah, I'll second.
Okay, I see Samantha turning her screen on. I want to offer some clarification that the first and the second is for the staff recommendation, authorize the mayor to submit the remaining portions of staff recommended letter to the Coastal Commission.
Thank you, Mayor.
May I have a roll call, please? You're welcome. May I have a roll call, please?
Yes. Councilmember Bertrand.
I approve.
Councilmember Kaiser.
Aye.
Councilmember Peterson.
Aye.
Vice Mayor Story.
Aye.
Mayor Brooks.
Aye. Okay, that item passes unanimously. Thank you, Council. We're going to move on to our last item of this evening. Thank you, Mr. Jesberg, for sticking with us.
Absolutely.
At the end of tonight.
I'm going to go ahead and share
my screen. It is item 8. Yes. Consider a cooperative agreement with the Santa Cruz County Regional Transportation Commission concerning the regional Monterey Bay Sanctuary Trail. And I can see your screen, Mr. Jesberg.
If I can make it in presentation form. There we go. Good evening, Mayor and Council. The item before you tonight, as you mentioned, is an agreement with the Santa Cruz County Regional Transportation Commission. I'm going to kind of review the project that this agreement deals with and go over some of the points of the contract or the agreement. So the project under consideration under this agreement is construction of a pedestrian pathway from the upper Beach and Village parking lot here behind City Hall. It goes up to Monterey Avenue and an improved pedestrian crossing at Monterey Avenue. To separate bikes and pedestrians, and improvements to the vacant RTC land at Monterey Avenue and Park Avenue. A bit of background is the Santa Cruz, the RTC has awarded $200,000 towards this project, and the city in previous years has appropriated $50,000 to this project. Those sums at this point today are probably not sufficient to complete the project, but I think we're probably 80% funded with those fundings. This agreement establishes the roles and responsibilities of each party and the requirements for rights to develop the project on the Santa Cruz County Regional Transportation owned railway right away. So I'll quickly kind of, this is a map from when we applied for the funding from the RTC. It shows the limits of it, and then I have some pictures to kind of help you tie in. So this is the upper, well, it was called Pacifico parking lot back when we started this project. Now it's the Beach and Village parking lot. And then this is the road or the driveway that goes up to the intersection of Park and Monterey. So there's, we will develop a trail, ADA compliant for bikes and bicycles that would go along the curb here, travel up to the right of way. And then from this point on, it becomes part of their rail trail that they're developing along their entire corridor. We would improve the crossing here. And then in the vacant lot, we would develop it. This is a landscaped area. We're gonna have to work with the RTC. A bus shelter is considered, but right now this bus stop is not part of the metro route. So it's an inactive turnout. So there's some changes in how this finally gets developed will be in conjunction with the RTC. Quickly, some pictures just to make sure we understand where we're talking. This is standing in the upper parking lot, looking at this Monterey. This truck, white truck back here, is on Monterey in the middle of the intersection. The path would start at this little nose that sticks out to the narrow part of the driveway. You see, here's a lady walking her dog, walking in the roadway because we do not have any other pathway for her to travel up there. Pathway would start here and fall along this curb line for a certain distance. It really hasn't been finalized at this point, but it would travel along this curb line, so we'd have an at-grade sidewalk in here that this lady could be walking on. It would continue up, here she is continuing on her walk, up into where we get a pretty good slope between the railroad tracks and the driveway here. And at some point it would start angling up into the hill and through the trees. As you can see, there's a significant amount of oak trees and other trees in this area. We will try our best to snake through these, but in reality, there will be a need to probably potentially remove some of these trees, unless we want to spend quite a bit of money building retaining walls and trying to isolate it within certain areas where we wouldn't impact the oak trees. Once you get to the top of the trail, you'll be here along the railroad track. This is standing at Monterey Avenue, looking down the railroad tracks. You'd be coming in somewhere in this location and headed toward me to come to Monterey Avenue. Just to give you an idea what the cross section looks like, this is a little backwards. Imagine we now turned around. Sorry about that, I just caught on. So the railroad tracks are over here, the trail's over here. We will have a fence between the two. It is consistent with the other portions of the rail trail that are being developed in City of Santa Cruz in the county in Watsonville. It's about a 4-foot high fence. And we'd also have a fence between the trail and the driveway going down to our parking lot just because of the grade changes there. So that's kind of how it would look. And then finally, you get to Monterey and Park Avenue. This is the crosswalk that would be improved to have bike lanes on the exterior and a marked designated crosswalk in the middle. So the cooperative agreement that's before you designates the city as the lead agency responsible for all aspects of the project. The city will prepare the design plans and specifications, including that as an estimate of the cost. We will be responsible for meeting with complying with CEQA, retaining all the permits, which would probably be a coastal permit, and we'd be responsible for construction, and I'd be bidding and managing the project. The Regional Transportation Commission would retain oversight. They would be issuing rights of entries to contractors, to ourselves, to engineers working on the project. And they would be ensuring consistency with this, with our design, with other designs going on in the corridor. So just to kind of give you an idea on the next steps, approval of this agreement does not mean we're ready to move forward with this project. First of all, the County of Santa Cruz is doing a comprehensive environmental and preliminary design for the corridor from Live Oak to Aptos, and it includes in it the city of Capitola. So we want to try and leverage that work as best we can before we start conducting our own studies. Ultimately, what needs to be conducted is a geotechnical study for designing of the pathway supports. As we wind up the hill, we're going to need some retaining walls, depending on how many, as we finalize the layout, the height of those walls could become substantial. So we will need to do the geotechnical testing. What we're really hoping to coordinate with the county's efforts is on the environmental studies that are required for the project. As I'm sure you're most aware, pollutants are on railroad corridors are in the soil itself are common. Arsenic is something that is typically found. Asbestos is possible from the brakes of the railroad. So we need to conduct environmental testing to determine the presence of the pollutants and develop a remediation plan consistent with whatever levels are found. We're kind of hoping the county can do that and come up with something that we can apply to our project. If they are unable to, or we are able to do it in a more concise manner, we will do it on ourselves. But those are two studies that need to be completed and necessary for this agreement before we can start them, before the project can go toward construction. And finally, we need to finalize the route. As I've kind of been talking off and on here, is the route between the trees and tree protection is something we're going to have to measure, figure out the best way. One end, you take down the trees, we build a single straight pathway. It's probably pretty simple. We probably can avoid a lot of retaining walls. Keeping all the trees is going to require quite a few retaining walls that will be very expensive. So we need to find a happy happy medium between those two. Also, minimizing the disturbance to the RTC corridor, because if we brought the pathway up, you know, closer and had more on the corridor, their potential will have more pollutant remediation in that area. So it's again, a balancing act to how much of the RTC corridor we're going to touch versus how much of the trees we're going to potentially impact. And then there's also ADA considerations. The entire pathway, as it leaves the parking lot up and to Monterey Avenue, will need to be ADA compliant, which basically means it can't be very steep, has to have turnarounds. If we have a U-turn in it, it needs to be a large landing. So that, again, adds to trying to minimize turns and things like that. So our recommended action tonight is to approve the agreement with Santa Cruz County Regional Transportation Commission for work on the Santa Cruz County branch line for construction of a pedestrian pathway along the rail line connecting with the Upper Beach and Village parking lot and Monterey Avenue. And that's my presentation. I'd be happy to answer any questions.
Vice Mayor Story.
Yeah, thanks, Dave, for the presentation. I guess I had a few questions, if I may, Mayor. When Steve, you mentioned that the whole project is about 80% funded. By my calculation, that's about $312,500. The trees that you identified, are those Capitola trees or RTC trees?
Part of this project will define that. I think it's about 50-50. I'm not quite sure where that line is up to the oak trees, but I do believe it comes somewhere down the middle of that hill.
Right. Does that 80% funding figure, does that include making a concerted effort to save those trees?
As I said, we will make a concerted effort to save the trees, but there may be some trade-offs that we have to identify. If we want to try and save them all, that 80% figure may be closer to a 60% figure, to be honest with you.
Yeah, okay. Good to know. The other, I recall, we've been talking about having a sidewalk going out of the parking lot for quite some time. Why are we taking the responsibility to carry this trail across Monterey and into the RTC lot?
I think it was, we saw this as an opportunity to maybe improve that vacant lot at the entrance to the village that probably more for beautification purposes than anything else, to make that lot look like it's part of a part of the city and part of a system rather than a vacant lot at this point.
Will there continue to be parking available?
So the RTC does not allow parking on that vacant lot. I know there are trucks there that park on occasion and other things, but during the festivals, there was no parking signs put up there. As part of this, that would eliminate the parking on that property.
And in the other, you talked about the environmental materials there, potential hazardous materials, asbestos. But in reading the agreement right, if it's type 2 hazardous materials, that's going to be on us to have it removed.
So yeah, without going through the agreement, if we find contaminants on there that need to be treated, no matter whether or not this project goes forward, then the RTC is responsible for that cost of the remediation plan and implementing remediation. If there are pollutants that can remain if it's not touched, but we have to remediate them as part of our project, then those costs will become part of the project costs. Now we can seek funding. I should talk about funding real quick if I can here. We do anticipate going back to the RTC to help fund any additional costs, but that remediation of materials that needs to be done because of the project would be part of a project cost.
Would be included in the project. And what would happen if we realized, this project is going to cost a lot more than, we have currently $250,000, as I understand it. If it costs $500,000 or more, what do we do? What happens then?
Well, one point, I don't think this agreement mandates that we complete the project. This is more the ground rules of that how we move forward to complete it. We would work with the RTC, see if they could provide, the exorbitant amount of money it may cost to develop it. And then, or we could potentially back off the project and decide not to move forward with it.
Okay, thanks, Steve.
Councilmember Bertrand.
Hi, Steve, thanks for your presentation. Have you considered going on the other side of the driveway that goes up to, Monterey?
We've looked at it. That is a wall, retaining wall that is holding up, and it's rather a sheer hillside at that point. So we'd have to cantilever a sidewalk out over the edge there and then have fencing. I think the cost of that alone, I have not costed out beyond, I just looked at it and went, that would be extremely expensive compared to going up the other side.
Okay, I just had to ask you that. So you're probably well aware that, you know, one of the main causes of cost overrun for the trails that were built in northern part of Santa Cruz was remediation issues. And, you know, I just think if we take on this project, we're going to be hit with that. And I think that's where Sam's going. But my main point is we have no clue. We have no idea what the plans for the corridor is going to be. It's in contention. So for us to be building something that's basically an adjunct to a trail that may not be there, or a trail that's going to be a different design, or maybe nothing at all, we have no idea at this point. The study that they're doing, they're preparing a study for something that RTC has no money to build at this point, came up in the last meeting. So I don't see any reason why we should jump ahead on this particular project to meet a deadline for something that doesn't even have a plan forward. And that's my question to you. Are we dovetailing with something that's going to be built? And, you know, we expect to, you know, meet the deadlines of, you know, the RTC's plan to build a trail, and we need to provide something, you know, in Capitola for that particular trail.
So we are following the guidelines that the RTC has currently adopted, which is the rail trail design guidelines.
Okay.
I know the county is moving forward with those as they do their environmental studies. Yeah. We will dovetail with the county preliminary designs because that's what's being designed right now. The RTC is going to change gears on us, then there may be other solutions or designs that are feasible out there. But right now, those are the guidelines that we're working under.
Okay. So I'm just positing that, you know, when we know what a plan is going to be for, you know, the majority, how many miles, 22 miles or something like that, of that particular corridor, and we just have this little egress, basically, you know, I kind of like to dovetail what we are going to do to what the overall plans are. Do you see a problem with that? I mean, why should we be doing something ahead of when we even know what the RTC is going to do?
Well, from our standpoint, we're gaining a much-needed pedestrian path between the parking lot and Monterey Avenue. To me, that is the goal of the project, is to, we really have a hard time putting a sidewalk anywhere else unless we run it up to the railroad. We can't run it along, just along the curb, along next to the road the whole way, because we can't meet ADA as we go up that hill to Monterey. And so once we hit that point, we no longer have a legal sidewalk. So I really think the benefit to the city is getting that connection in, and also providing development of that vacant lot so it's no longer a vacant lot. The rail trail in our very small portion that we're building has kind of slowed down this project enormously because they've gone through so many iterations of it, but that is a necessary part to get this very essential sidewalk from the upper parking lot to Monterey Avenue.
So my next question to you is, can we do the walkway, if you want to call it, from the parking lot up to the intersection of you know, Park and Monterey, but not do the other side? Because I have, you know, personally have no idea what's going to happen on the other side. I see the advantage of getting a walkway, despite the fact we're going to lose some trees. And you know, it's been brought up by other council members that, you know, we need some science about that whole area because it's an area we need to address. But do we have to do both sides?
So you're saying we have to do the vacant lot on the...
Yeah, forget that for the time being and just do the driveway, walkway first.
That would be a modification of the project description with the RTC, but I can't really speak for them. I think they would potentially see that as something they would accept, because I know they're looking at what to do with that whole side of the road as part of the county study going on there. But we'd have to approach them on that. The agreement does allow for changes in the project description. So if we did approve the agreement tonight and with direction to change the project description, that's something we could move forward with.
Thank you, Steve.
Just a couple thoughts here really quickly. This project, I think Steve made this clear, but this project was originally conceived of totally independent of the rail trail. It was really about finding a safe way for people to leave the upper lot to the east. And ultimately, we settled on having pedestrians access the rail trail as the most efficient way to get, access the rail corridor as the most efficient way to get people out of the parking lot safely. So, you know, its relationship to the rail trail is tenuous at best. It's a standalone project that the city conceived of far before anybody had any plans for a rail trail. And then just to also add, Jacques, about the Councilor Vautrin, about the little kind of vacant lot corner, that was really intended to be just sort of a cleanup, but that's a real gateway to our village, and really trying to get in there, curb and gutter, a little bit of landscaping, a nice entrance into the village as you come up the hill and then drop down into the village. So that's really what that part of the project was about getting a nice kind of a finished corner rather than just a vacant lot right as you come into the village.
Yeah, I can see the point of what you're making, and I remember walking with you trying to figure out how to make that trail work. You know, we're actually up there together. So I totally understand that. I totally understand the benefit to Capitola. But, you know, we're rubbing up against something else that is much larger, and I don't know if I want to feed into that. There may be other ways for us to get a pathway up that driveway, and so that's just my thoughts at this point.
Any other questions? Councilmember Kaiser, you have your question?
Yeah, thanks. I think I did kind of have the same question along as Councilmember Bertrand, as far as is it necessary to have the trail crossing the intersection? Obviously, intersections, I think, can be a little bit hairy. And so if we are just having that trail just take a, or the corridor just take a hard right once it gets to Monterey, and then not having to involve spending money and stuff on property that is RTC, whether they're helping us or not, just to try to not bite off more than we can chew right off the bat, but maybe it's something that we could add on if there's a second phase to it. Also, I don't know if there's a little bit more space sort of on that right-hand side, looking at the ocean, where the train tracks are, if there's space there to sort of enhance that, maybe with a bench or a resting place, that would be ADA compliant. That's like right there, when you come up to the intersection, you are still seeing that. Maybe it's a little bit smaller scale than whatever would be across the street. But I think it's a great idea, and thank you for putting in the man hours and looking into it.
Councilmember Peterson.
Thank you. I just want to confirm with staff and to clarify that this is a project separate from what we are used to hearing as the rail trail issue that's going on in our county, that this is unrelated. This is just a pedestrian path that goes from our parking lot to get people up to the village, and is not part of that larger project that we're not expecting to see come to our town in any time in the very near future. Can staff confirm that?
So from our standpoint, yes, that's true. But the part of the project that is on the railroad property needs to comply with the standards that they have established for the rail trail.
Sure.
But it's not really, if you look at the other projects, the other jurisdictions, they're building miles and miles of rail trail right now. That's what the county is looking at. We're building maybe 50 feet. Yes, it's going to comply with what those standards are, but I wouldn't say it's a significant, you can't say we're building the rail trail. We're building this pathway, and part of it is complying with that. Does that make sense?
Yes, absolutely. Thank you.
Thank you.
That's my story.
I just wanted to follow up on that segment that is on the rail trail. What is the future plan? Will that ultimately continue on the rail trail to cross the trestle and continue to go east toward New Brighton? And if it were, when will all that happen? And I had a follow-up about the landscaping across Monterey. Is there a commitment that that will stay in place once the RTC does get in there and start building the rest of the trail?
So to answer the first part, as far as when will the rest of the rail trail come in, I don't know how to answer that. That's a tough one. There's the county is doing some preliminary design and environmental work to look at that whole from Live Oak to Aptos, including Capitola. When that work is done, that's probably still at least a year out. There's no funding for it identified. Does it include the rail, the trestle, railroad trestle over Soquel Creek? That's what they're looking at right now, what those options are. And I think the timing is many, many years away before we see that development come in. As far as the landscaping, I think there's been no commitment from the RTC that if they come in and want to build something different there, that they will not utilize that landscaping. In fact, I don't think, I know the plan that I showed had landscaping in it, and that was from when we first pitched this project to the RTC. I think since then, we've kind of realized there probably won't be much landscaping. It'll be more of a developed pathway and bus stop area than it would be. There might be some small bits of landscaping that if we do it in conjunction with the RTC right now and their planning, that those parts should remain.
Thank you.
Okay, any other questions at this time? Councilmember Bertrand, is your hand raised? You're muted.
No questions. We have to wait for public comment. My problem.
Yes. Okay. We will move this to public comment. I see.
Yes, Mayor Brooks, I have Barry Scott wanting to talk on this item.
Mr. Scott, welcome.
Hello. Thank you for having this topic up. My name is Barry Scott. I live in Aptos, and I've been a board member for 4 or 5 years of Friends of the Rail and Trail, and I'm actually pretty excited to see this happening. I wanted to mention that the environmental mitigation that took place in Santa Cruz is where Neri Lagoon is. It's just a substantial wildlife, water, you know, riparian habitat. With an extreme topography and terrain situation, and there were some local folks who were adamant about sure that extra measures were taken. I don't see that happening in anything in this little section. I'm looking at the map. I've been looking at the plans for a couple of years since they were first started. I wanted to speak to the Jacques and Sam's concern that we don't know what we're doing with the rail corridor. I can tell you that the tracks are going to be there for a very, very long time. And the 120 or 150 feet of on the east side of Monterey, where trail is planned to be built within the corridor by the RTC, and modifications to the street there that will include a bus bay, it will turn out for the bus line. It's not like we're going to find out that the Greenway side is going to win this and get the tracks removed. That is just so unlikely that I think I'd love to see Capitola go with the RTC, not jeopardize its funding, and work in a cooperative fashion with them. You know, I agree with Steve. There's an opportunity here. And it'd be great to see Capitola join Watsonville and Santa Cruz as municipalities that have permitted some trail to be constructed. I don't think that we're going to see drastic changes where the tracks are removed and the trail is going to become something else. And that's all I have to say. I thank you, and I hope you'll support this this partnership with the RTC.
Thank you. Thank you, Mr. Scott. Okay, let's bring this back to council for further discussion and a vote. Councilmember Bertrand, your hand is raised.
Yeah, I'd like to make a motion to approve this agreement with the Santa Cruz County Regional Transportation Committee, but to bifurcate the project. We'll accept the conditions, which seem very reasonable. I went through them all. And we'll do the project from the parking lot up to the Monterey Park Avenue intersection. And I think strapping is certainly of order to go around the intersection. Does definitely needs approval. But wait till later before we continue the rest of the project after we get more clear plans from the RTC, and their project is ongoing. So it would split it into two parts, as Steve suggested, and that's the motion I'm making.
Okay, we have a first. I
can second that.
Okay, we have a first and a second on the table. Is there any further discussion? Councilmember Peterson.
I just want to clarify, the motion sounded like that was staff recommendation, but that wasn't the staff recommendation in the packet, is that correct?
Yeah, if I could clarify, when I was talking to Steve about doing one part of the project first, the trail up to the intersection, and leaving the rest for later when we're a little bit more clear about what RTC is going to be planning and eventually doing, if that's what's going to happen. He suggested bifurcating the project. And so I was just trying to use his words or his way of looking at it, that's all. So the motion is to approve the agreement, but as we move forward, we would move forward on the planning and the eventual carrying out of the walkway up to the intersection of Monterey and Park, but leave the rest till later.
On the agenda this evening is the agreement with the RTC. My recommendation would be to take action on the agreement with the RTC and then maybe direct staff to come back maybe in the budget cycle or something with information about the project, and you can really understand kind of what the project looks like and all the different components. Because my feeling is that making changes to it right now, you may or may not have a complete picture. The full council has a complete picture of what the project is.
Well, then, if that's your recommendation, it would be too confusing, then I'll withdraw my motion and make another motion to oppose this agreement with the RTC, Santa Cruz Regional Transportation Commission.
I'll second that.
Okay, we have a first and a second on the table. Do we have any further discussion?
Yes, I'm only pulling this because Jamie suggests, it would be a little bit difficult and there'd be final more discussion and stuff like that. So I kind of like to make the process simple. And, behind the scenes, maybe there's going to be some other discussion about, trying to get the sense of how, at least I think, and maybe some other people on the commission here thinks.
If I could just clarify, Jamie, before you jump back in, it to me, and I didn't make any comments earlier, so I just want to add a little insight to this. It sounds like there's just some more to it that we're looking for, some more information, and as you're suggesting, it could come back to us at a later time with more information and what the project would look like. Is that what I'm hearing you say?
My suggestion is that the agreement, the action in front of you is to approve the agreement with the RTC, which lays out the framework to move a project forward, independent of what that project is. So my recommendation is move that forward. And then what you probably, it sounds like, would like to do, because this project was originally developed 6 or 7 years ago, is maybe get a little bit more details on it. And then if you want to pare it back in some way, do that. I mean, at this point, it's an older project, CIP project, and so I think it would make sense to deeply sort of dive into this project and figure out, do you want to work at all the east side of Monterey or not? So that's my suggestion.
Okay,
Okay. I have some concern about, pardon me, but I have some concern, though, that us approving what's in front of us today is including what Councilmember Bertrand and Vice Mayor Story are concerned about, that extra piece. So my concern is if we move forward with this agreement this evening, I just want us to be clear tonight, if we move forward with this agreement tonight, it's about this relationship and getting funding for a project, and we at a later time would decipher what that project would be. Is that what I'm hearing you say, Jamie?
Can I interject real quickly here? There is a project description in the agreement that talks about the project I laid out tonight. So that is in the agreement, but there is clearly language in the agreement that we can modify that project description at a later date. Actually, I think, and so we could come back, we could, like I said earlier, we could approve the agreement tonight, get directions from you to try and modify that project description within the agreement itself, and move forward from there. So I think you're all right that the project in this agreement does specify a project, and that was going to be one of my questions. We could break it into two phases and see if they would agree that phase one was something we could construct now, and phase two would be something we would construct later, or we could propose to the RTC about just eliminating that. But right now, that project description is part of the agreement, but we can modify it.
Okay, that offers some clarity, and it for me, Council, it seems like it's a little, we're jumping the gun here. It sounds like there's a little bit more to it, and it would be nice to start the conversation with the full Council from the beginning, so that the agreement at face value would read what the Council would agree on. Council Member Peterson, did you have some comments?
Yeah, and just I feel like we're getting a little bit in the weeds on a project that's essentially just a path. It's just a pedestrian path. It goes from our parking lot up to Monterey Avenue, and I feel like we're reading a little bit into it as being part of a much larger rail trail issue, and I'm concerned that we're making this something a little bit bigger than it needs to be. And so I hear the concerns that people are raising. I'm also hearing from our staff that we can move forward with staff recommendation now and determine at a later date if changes need to be made. But I mean, this has been going since 2014, since before three quarters of us were ever even on council. Or forgive me, Jacques, I think you might have been there already. So my apologies. But I'm concerned about the idea of essentially starting this all from scratch, and I'm not sure that anyone's with me on this, but for the sake of the fact that we already have a motion and a second, I would need, I guess, clarification if I were to make a substitute motion to move forward with staff's recommended action. Sam, is that all? City Attorney Sam, is that all I need to do is just make a substitute motion and hope for a second, or is there something else that needs to happen?
No, you could do that.
Okay, well then then that's what I'm proposing, is a substitute motion to move forward with staff recommendation, and that staff will return to us with additional information for any changes that could or need to be made in the future.
And I'll second that.
As a point of order, isn't there already a substitute motion on the? Jacques made a substitute motion.
Well, I went through my motion because Jamie suggested that there'd be some issues with the the discussion with the RTC. So they both got seconded. Once by City Council Kaiser and once by you. So are we open for discussion now, Mayor?
Let me just check in with our attorney. Pardon me, Vice Mayor. I just want to check in with our attorney here to make sure that we're following the rules. Okay, so we had a first by Councilmember Bertrand and a second by Councilmember Story. And at that point,
Councilmember Peterson made a substitute motion and got a first and a second. Can you give me some guidance on what to do next?
Sure. So the second motion is the one that you vote on first.
Mm-hmm.
So you would call for the vote on Councilmember Peterson's motion.
Okay, so I'm going to take Councilmember Peterson's motion and the second to a vote now. May I have a roll call, please?
Yes.
We're not going to have any more discussion on the motion.
So we have a first.
That's at the mayor's pleasure. If you'd like to call for the vote now, you can call for the vote. If you'd like to enter discussion, that's fine too.
Vice Mayor Story, you had more to add?
Well, I wanted to speak to the motion. This is a new motion. I haven't had a chance to speak.
To Councilmember Peterson, if you'd like to add. Okay. Vice Mayor Story, were you going to add, you wanted to make some comments to Councilmember Peterson's motion?
I did. Yes.
Please.
You know, to me, this is very much a part of the rail trail. It never started out that way, but it has become that. And I think from the discussion tonight, it's fairly obvious that it is. And that's the design of the project is reflective of that. But aside from all that, the agreement I view to be flawed because, one, we're dealing with a project that we don't know the cost of, and it has shifting responsibilities from the RTC to the city of Capitola. And it has responsibilities concerning hazardous materials, which becomes our responsibility to clean up under this agreement. And that could be a very huge, ticket item. At least there should be some testing done before we enter into that kind of commitment. So that's why I would oppose entering into this agreement. I don't think the city should be there cleaning up the hazardous material that should be the RTC's responsibility. My other concern is that the trees that are on the property, we do not yet know whether or not some of them are going to be removed because of this project. And I would certainly want to know that and what that would cost and what it would cost to protect those trees if we were to move forward with it. So it seems like we're putting the cart before the horse. We're entering into an agreement without knowing many of the fundamental material terms of the agreement and the impacts that it's going to have on the city. So I think we should at least insist that background information be provided before we make a decision on it. Thank you.
Thank you, Vice Mayor. My feelings are mutual, and I just want to be clear because I seconded Councilmember Peterson's motion with the impression that those things would take place as even though we approve the contract. If I am wrong, I would really like staff to let me know that I'm wrong in believing that. So everything that Councilmember Vice Mayor Story just said, I am, from what I'm hearing from staff this evening, is that all of those things would be addressed and that it will come back to council for final approval with all of that information about the trees, about the extra spot across the street, all of that would come back to council. By just approving this tonight is just moving us forward in that direction. And if it comes back and it's all horrible about asbestos, we could rescind that contract. Am I wrong? Because I seconded Councilmember Peterson's motion. I just want to be clear because I'm in agreement with Vice Mayor Story.
So Mayor Brooks, I believe you are correct. What we're doing tonight is an agreement that will allow us to continue working on the project. For example, we cannot do environmental studies to look for contaminants without a right of entry from the RTC. This is the agreement they want us to enter into before we get those right of entries. We can work on the tree issue and try and get back to you on that independent of this agreement, to be honest with you. It's just a matter of taking a look at it, but that involves some geotechnical studies that we need to do, which we can't do without this agreement. So we will be returning to the council with that information to kind of finalize the scope of the project. And we can also, in the meantime, talk about to the RTC about splitting it into two projects. But right now, we can't advance the design or the studies without entering an agreement to at least be able to work on the property.
Thank you. Councilmember Bertrand.
You know, I couldn't agree more with what Sam said. And, you know, Mayor, I see that these are concerns of yours, and I respect everyone on the board here that has those concerns. So my original motion was to split the project and our approval at this point. I don't want to wait for discussion with RTC and everything on the background, and, you know, we're sort of forced into something that we don't want to do. I see that there's problems working, putting that pathway in. It is, as Sam say, going to be part of the rail trail. And, you know, in a sense, we're going along with this plan at this point, if we pass it. But I also see the advantage, excuse me, the benefit to the people who walk up that driveway of putting a pathway in there. So that's why my first motion was to split the two parts of this project. And at this point, I don't see anything wrong with that. That still gives us an option to get on the land to test for environmental concerns. As Steve said, he could do his best to wind around the trees, which will probably make the path a little more interesting. So, you know, I think there's going to be good staff support to make that happen. But I have no idea what the future of that segment is going to be on the other side, which is now a dusty path of rocks, patch of rocks. You're absolutely right, Jamie. It doesn't look very good. Many entrances to Capitola don't look very good, like at Bay Avenue. But, you know, I want to wait to see what the RTC actually puts on the table is going to be a plan. We don't have it yet. And the way it looks right now, it's going to be 10, 15 years or more. It's not going to happen that quick. There's going to be a lot of studies. That's what the RTC has been doing, lots of studies. Because there's no money to build what we're studying to do. So I gotta, you know, I'm sorry, Kristen, you know, normally I support your motions, but this one I have to not support. It just, you know, it doesn't make sense when I look at how this rail trail plan is unfolding, part of the rail trail, you could get me going on this. You really could. And it's not part of the discussion right now. But if at some point those plans are put before Capitola, that we have the plans ready to go with the rail trail or just the rail or what's just the trail, fine. And they have the money to do it, fine. We could contribute and do our part to make this a whole trail or whatever it's going to be. But at this point, we have no clear idea. So if this fails, I'm going to put my original motion back on to bifurcate the projects and approve the agreement, but to just do the portion from the parking lot up to the intersection. Thank you.
Thank you, Councilmember. Councilmember Kaiser.
Thanks, Mayor. Steve, I was just wondering, is there like a hard deadline on this with the RTC? I didn't really see anything. Or if between that timeline, would we be able to do the minimal kind of homework that we can do before signing on to this to kind of get some more clear view as to make everybody more comfortable moving forward? Or is this something that needs to be done like this week and, you know, to get the process started?
This project's been on the books for so long, there's no hard and fast deadline at this point. We're just trying to take the next step to move it forward. As far as gathering information, we can, you know, kind of lay things out, but I can't come back to you with what it's going to cost to build a trail here versus there, if there's retaining walls involved, without doing a geotechnical report. And I can't address the contamination. We may be able to address the contamination or a pollutant issue once the county of Santa Cruz completes their initial study. That's probably a year away.
Okay.
It's been a while since I've checked in on that project, but I think that's a reasonable timeline. So we could certainly wait till then. This project is not going anywhere. We just don't have a pathway up, a good way out of the parking lot.
Right. Okay. Thanks for clarifying.
Okay. So we have a first and a second on the table. Can I have a roll call, please?
Chloe, can you confirm or can you restate? Yes.
Thank you.
This is Councilmember Peterson's substitute motion to move forward with the recommended action from staff to then bring back more information at a future time. It was seconded by Mayor Brooks. Okay? Great.
Thank you.
Okay, great. So, Councilmember Bertrand.
No.
Councilmember Kaiser.
Aye.
Councilmember Peterson.
Aye.
Vice Mayor Story.
No.
Mayor Brooks.
Aye.
Thank you.
Okay. All right, folks. We did it. We've okay. made it.
Good meeting.
We're at item 9, adjournment. I want to thank council. I would like to thank staff, and I'd like to thank the participants for being here tonight. In light, again, and everything that's going on out in the world, and we need to remember, we need to condemn the hate and the racism and the violence going on in our community and throughout our country. So please, please, please remember to find the good in others and yourselves. Good night.
Thank you. Night.
Goodbye.
Jesus Christ. Oh, okay. Ugh.